Heavenly Father, we thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. We praise you, Father. We praise you, Father. We thank you for who you are. We praise you for how awesome, awesome God that you are to us, how merciful you are, even when we get thrown into our situations here in life and our own versions of a boiling pot of oil. Father God, you pull us through, and we just thank you and praise you for every step of the way that you're helping to train us and to refine us and to seek you even more than we've ever sought you before in our lives, to find that place of comfort, Father, that we need so desperately, to reside in that secret place, to dwell indeed in that secret place of the Most High, to look forward to that time and prayer in the early morning hours and also intermittently throughout the day as we bump up against obstacles and challenges and things that we don't think we're able to accomplish, but we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us, and we just have to believe and have faith and reach out to our friends and fellow saints for prayer when that's available to us. And for those that don't know anybody, Father, we just pray that you will introduce them somehow, electronically or whatever the case may be, through Facebook or whatever media, social media there may be out there. Father, we just need to be able to unite together more than ever before, that we can seek one another in prayer and to be able to gain that confidence that we ought to have, knowing that you will give us those many miracles in just the nick of time. Father, we know that it's all part of our testing, our refining, to maintain that faith and to believe that that these various obstacles that we may or may not have to go through at different times, or we definitely do have to go through at different times in our lives. Father God, we just know that you're going to be there for us, and we praise you for that, because I don't think any of us could deal with the things that are being thrown at us in so many different directions and so many different parts of our lives, that Father, without your help and without that peace that passes all understanding to come upon us through Christ Jesus, knowing that we have lifted our petitions before you, Father, that you love us and that you will bring us through whatever it is that we're going through at any given time. We lift you up and praise you, Father God, for the things that are happening around the world. We ask you, Father, in concert, in synergy with the word of knowledge that was given to Sister Diana Pulliam, Father, we will raise up before thee a petition in the name of Jesus to continue forward with your judgments. Father, none of us can pretend to understand why or the timing or how this all works. All we know is what has been witnessed unto our hearts, and we do and are able to deduce and praise your holy name for that, Father, through maybe perhaps your wisdom, that all these things are called into action by the prayers of the saints that are praying effective and fervently on behalf of the kingdom. And we just give you all the praise and honor and worship and glory, Father God, and help us to be able to understand and to realize, to become that which you need us to be, that with, as it says in Isaiah 43:25, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake, and I will not remember your sins. Keep me in remembrance, and let us contend together. Father, we come before you and we ask you in the name of Jesus that we will not lose the momentum that we have lost. I will continue to pray this in concert with the word of knowledge that was given to Sister Diana. I will continue to pray this, and I pray that other people will join me in this prayer. Father, we want to get this over with. We know that these things are moving forward because you have lifted your hand of protection off of this earth. We understand that the forces of darkness are working exceedingly hard to put into effect their master program, to essentially using the, it almost appears that in some cases that they're using the Bible as a type of a playbook. And Father, and that we would know, Father God, would be your will, because you are the author. You are Jesus. You are the Word, and we stand upon that Word stronger, more strongly now than we've ever stood upon it before, because there's so much confusion that's associated with our walk nowadays. So many things that have been prophesied that even within the last couple of years have kind of gone askew. We believe with all of our heart, Father God, that these are not people that have ill intent, and we believe in the name of Jesus, Father, with all of our heart, that we're all in this together, and we ask you, Father, to just protect us from the unintentional words that are being proclaimed in your name. Some of them are coming from sources that aren't exactly walking precisely the way that you want them to walk. We don't know. We don't judge. But Father, we just pray that you will give us an extra portion, a double portion of your discernment, and to help us to understand that it is our prayers, that we work in concert together, that it is the prayers of the saints and your will, Father God, that together create that power that launched down the the angels that bring down the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ in a supernatural way that affects the entire earth in ways that we cannot even begin to comprehend. And we just lift up this world before you, Father God. We know that you sent Jesus for the entire world. We know there's 123 different countries out there, if you include the island nation states, Father. And we pray for every single one of the saints out there, Father, no matter where they are in their walk, no matter whether they are baby Christians, whether they have just met Jesus and asked him into their heart, whether they are struggling, no matter what condition that they are in, we're asking you, Father, to pour out your spirit upon all flesh as you have promised in Joel 2 and Acts 2:17 through 21. Pour out your spirit in the name of Jesus upon all flesh. Touch the people and raise them up, Father, across this world. Anybody who's living in a state of deception or has bought into a particular belief system that is distracting them from the reality of the days that we live in, Father, we ask you in the name of Jesus to touch them. Father, to touch them and to bring them into unity, because we need unity amongst the saints right now more than ever before. We pray in the name of Jesus, Father God, for a supernatural holy fire to surround around about us on all sides, indeed to envelope each and every one of us as we walk. We ask Father God for that dispatch of the holy fire to swirl throughout our jobs and our workplaces for those of us who have to work, to give us divine protection. Father, that divine protection which has been promised us all throughout your scripture, providing that we fear you, providing that we do everything we can to be obedient, and we walk, Father, as close as we can and dwell with you in that secret place of the Most High. And we lift up before you, Father, in the name of Jesus, and pray that this is an effective, fervent prayer before your throne, and it is in concert with your will that you will bring down additional judgments. We understand, Father God, that Isaiah 26 verse 9 says, when your judgments are in the earth, the inhabitants of the world will learn righteousness. And Father God, we understand that these things are going to bring a lot of people home to heaven that otherwise would not have a chance. And Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that these things will continue to move forward. We're not especially excited to have to be a part of it. Father, we admit that we would like to just come home now, but yes, we will, and we are ready to serve you no matter what it takes. And if it is our destiny, Father God, to go through some difficult times, to have the lights go out, to have things happen to us that we're maybe not don't feel prepared to deal with in the flesh, Father, we know that you will supernaturally protect us. You will keep us warm. You will place food in our cabinets when our cabinets are empty. You will give us the means to be able to survive and serve you, especially in particularly for those of us who are working very hard on behalf of your will as your servants here on this earth. And we need to be able to touch other people and bring them along. We need to awaken people as much as is possible, Father. And it is not possible to continue to awaken people with any kind of momentum at all if there is a significant lull in the birth pangs, Father. As we see the numbers, these numbers that they've been evilly, in an evil manner, manipulating over the last year and plus, Father, we know the evil that's behind it. We know they've been manipulating numbers for many different seeding evil reasons, Father, but we just pray in the name of Jesus as they continue to manipulate those numbers even more, and they are showing the world that for lack of a better term, these bioweapon COVID numbers are decreasing right now. We understand, Father, in the name of Jesus, and we praise your holy name, that this could be a deception. We know that they could be preparing to launch something even darker upon mankind, and there could be other things that are teed up right now, Father God, that are going to come be brought down upon this earth that we are unaware of. Father, we thank you for keeping us at the ready. We thank you, Father God, and we pray in the name of Jesus that you will continue to maintain this momentum. It does us no good to be warning people about the days that we are in, to let them know that this is the time that Jesus is about to come upon the earth. Father God, it does us no good if we lose our momentum and people just go back to their daily lives as usual, as they did after 9/11. And Father, we just pray in Jesus' name, in accordance with your will, we pray that your will be done. And we ask you, Father, to maintain that momentum, to maintain the things, no matter what they are, whether they are geological in nature, whether they are earthquakes, whether they are incredibly unbelievable apocalyptic weather patterns, whether they are whatever kind of calamity, whatever kind of unexplainable event that may be about to be brought upon this earth, Father, we ask you to accelerate it as you have mentioned that you would through your servants, the prophets, even before the seducing spirits were released around about 2016, at least as best as we can tell. And Father, we just pray in Jesus' name that series of events that you have queued up, Father God, that are all somewhere buried within your Bible, maybe not every single one of them, but a lot of them are. And Father, we just pray in the name of Jesus just, Father, that you will please, in the name of Jesus, Father, keep these things moving forward, that your servants are able to continue to touch people. If we have awakened people, if we have planted seeds, if they have rejected those seeds, as it suggests that they would in Matthew 22, and no doubt, Father God, that we are the servants that are in the very beginning of Matthew 22, verses 1, 2, and 3. Father, we just pray in the name of Jesus that you will help to enable us, help us to be able to help you, help us to be able to bring your will into effect upon this earth. Help us, Father God, in the name of Jesus. Make us at the ready. Give us the strength that we need. Help us to be able to have the humility in our heart and the love and the compassion of our Lord Jesus Christ to pray for the lost and the people that will be affected by the things that are about to befall us. And we just give you all the praise and honor and glory and worship, Father God, for you alone are worthy. We cannot do this without you. We cannot do this without you, Jesus. We look forward to being able to stand before you. We pray always to be found worthy to escape all these things that are about to come upon the earth. We give you glory, and we pray in the name of Jesus that we're able to stand before you, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. And now to him, Lord Jesus, who is able to keep us from stumbling, please do, Father. Lord Jesus, please prop us up and give us extra angels. SEAL team, seven angels, Father God. Some of the most capable and strong angels that you have at your disposal. We ask for those to be assigned to us, to be assigned to us and to protect us, to protect our dwelling places, to come upon our loved ones, to strengthen us and to go and to ferret out any attempts of the darkness to attack us from indirect threat vectors, Father. We need this stability in our walk like never before, Father, and so that we are able to serve you in an incredible manner, Father God, that we know that is a part of our destiny and our calling, Father. In the name of Jesus, we pray. In Jesus' name, Father, in Jesus' name, that you will keep this momentum moving, that these things will continue to come to pass, that our words will not fall in vain upon the hearts and the minds of those that we have touched through our testimony, through our nudging, through our pointing at the events around the world and helping people to understand that these are the days, this is the day that the Lord hath made, and indeed that this is the day, that these are the days that Jesus warned us about in the Olivet Discourse. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus, that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, and hallowed and holy is thy name. Glory to you, Father God, and thank you for the strength and that supernatural peace that passes all understanding to come upon each of our hearts and minds. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray and thank you, Father. Amen. Hallelujah.
Well, praise God. Hallelujah. Where do you begin? All I can tell you is, folks, we're on a roller coaster ride, and we're, you know, it's that. How does that go? There's a saying. It's like a maybe from a TV show or something. You know, we're around and around and around. She. Oh, it's the thing that they say at the carnivals. It's probably from some other. I don't know, but round and around she goes, and where she stops, nobody knows. Hallelujah, right, kids? Isn't that right? Something like that. No, Spanky, put down the sign. I'm not going to do the Charlotte's Web thing. Come on. I'm not. What? No, come on. No. Look. Okay. Okay, I'll do it. All right. But only because you kids are such good Jesus kids. Okay. Here we go. A fair is a veritable smorgasbord, orgasbord, orgasbord, after the gates have shut. Each night when the lights go down, it can be found on the ground all around. Oh, how a rat can glut. What do you think, kids? Not enough, huh? Oh, you want more? Oh, for crying out loud. Oh, man. Goodness gracious, Mel and rinds and bits of hot dogs, cookie crumbs and rotten cotton candy, melted ice cream, mustard dripplings, moldy goodies everywhere. Oh, lots of popcorn, apple cores, banana peels and soggy sandwiches and gobs of gorgeous cook to gobble at the fair. Oh man, my BP shot up to like some insane. I can tell when, you know, I have this really weird. My dad died from it, so it's like, you know, whatever. It's kind of like runs in the family. That and generalized anxiety disorder, which is just a blessing. Let me tell you what. So you put high blood pressure, insanely high blood pressure, along with generalized anxiety disorder, and you have a walking time bomb. Hello, hello, anybody home?
Think big fly. But anyway, yeah, my BP shot up, you know, toward the end, it was in that interim period of time as my day job was ramping down and the radio show was approaching, the beginning of the radio show was approaching. It was one of those things where, you know, when you, I have what's called, it's the worst case scenario with the BP. It's called resistive and reactive high blood pressure. Now, reactive high blood pressure is also given this, it's given a nickname by the doctors. It's known as white coat syndrome. And that came because, you know, when they originally discovered it, they discovered that certain people, when they go into the doctor's office and they're around white coats, you know, people wearing white coats, that their BP will shoot up. But really, a better name for it is called reactive. When you have something happen that, you know, makes you feel uncomfortable or whatever the case is, or, you know, you know, meteors are shooting down at your house. Although I think I would pretty much be happy with that. If I saw a bunch of meteors heading at my house, just like Woody Harrelson in the movie 2012, I'm pretty sure I'd be like, yeah, I'd be like, you know, running around to the left, to the right, you know, making sure I get in the way of one of them so I can go home and be with Jesus. Hallelujah. But anyway, I'm, you know, but of course, one of them hit close enough, whatever. But yeah, so I've got that problem. And then I've also got resistive high blood pressure, which means that, you know, it doesn't matter what the doctor puts you on. Eventually you will either become used to it and it won't work anymore, or they'll slather multiple ones on you, and then you have to deal with all of the side effects. So I feel pretty good right at the moment, so that's a good sign. But sometimes when I have to bring it down, you know, manually, I call it manually, but what it is that, you know, you take your normal meds, you know, and anybody out there who has a high BP or any of those kinds of things, you got to take, you know how it is. You got to, you know, well, once a day or twice a day or whatever, you know, your prescription is. But in my case, because I have that reactive thing, sometimes I can feel it shoot up, you know, where I can actually feel my, you know, it's thumping, you know, I can feel my, you know, veins and things thumping, and I know it's like super high, like ER high, and then I have to actually bring it down with my meds. So I have like a take as needed medication, which is extremely effective. It's the same thing that they give you if you have to go to the emergency room and get it brought down. Well, I got that in pill form, praise God, because my doctor knows how, what a pain in the honey cheeks it is to bring mine down sometimes, right, kids? So I needed a little bit of Charlotte's Web, right, kids? I mean, come on. Sometimes we just got to chill out a little bit. Too many weird things going on out there. I mean, now you got people. See, this drives me. But we all have to come to a place. I know this is hard. Believe me, I know it's very, very hard. But somehow we have to come to a place whereby the things that trouble us don't like trouble us. Now, you're probably going, okay, here he goes. He's going on one of those philosophical Jesus rants where it makes no sense and blah, 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 and that kind of thing. And I hope that it makes sense. I hope it helps somebody. I'm working on it for my own self as well. And I know, and I'm also coaching other people that I run across, you know, through electronic communications, et cetera, as well, because I see them going through similar dynamics. So my assumption would be that if I'm seeing it pretty much, you know, like once every couple of days, somebody sends me an email and they're in a bad state of mind. And for whatever reason, it really, at the end of the day, there are always going to be some reason or group of reasons. That's the worst case scenario, is when you're getting hit with several groups of reasons, boom, 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 you know, it's coming at you from the left, the right, from above, you know, when they stack up on you and you got multiple issues that you're dealing with. It could be a dying relative happening at the same time that your pet is starting to pass away, or it could be something that happened on your job that, you know, is job threatening, and who wants to be without a job in the middle of the COVID thing? I mean, you know, that is like the worst case scenario. So we need super duper natural divine protection. That's why I call down and I ask the Lord, and I mean it too. I want SEAL Team 7 angels. That, look, our Heavenly Father likes the number 7, so my assumption has to be that he has got some pretty hardcore SEAL Team 7 Delta Force angels that he can assign upon request, and that's what I ask for, praise God. And I know just from years and years and years of going through these things that we have what's called direct threat vectors, things that can, whereby we can be attacked directly. versus indirect threat vectors, whereby an attack through the demonic realm can come against us because an entity of the darkness is leveraging something that they can get to you by going to people at your workplace, people at your job, people, you know, one of your kids could go start doing things that are just absolutely terrible, maybe break the law. Now you're bailing them out of jail, whatever the case may be. But that isn't no, that's what you would call an indirect threat vector. So I always pray that God sends angels and holy fire down to protect me. And I hope that you do this as well for yourself against all, you know, not just direct threat vectors, but also indirect threat vectors. Pray for anything. Think about anything that the devil can get to you. If the devil and his demons and the darkness and the witch covens that are coming against anybody, look, if you're causing problems for the devil, which you ought to be, then, you know, through your prayer and spiritual warfare tactics and things like we do on the prayer vigil on Friday night, if that's who you are and who you have become as a saint, you are the devil's worst enemy. You have, believe you me, you have a, your face is tacked up on the wall in Satan's office in hell as you know, you know, Satan's top 10 wanted list. And that's where you want to be. You want to be as much, you want to cause as much havoc for the darkness right now, especially than any other time. And that's done through our prayers, through, you know, different prayer tactics and warfare prayers and things like that. And when you're on that front line, you're going to take shrapnel. You know, sometimes you're just going to get body parts blown off. Now, this is a metaphor, but essentially you get purple heart. And that walk can be exceedingly difficult. It requires, you know, if you're just kind of going along and praying and doing your normal thing because that's what you've always done as a Christian all your life, well, you're probably not going to take on too much. You know, you're not going to get hit too hard. You know, you'll be able to coast right along and everything will be honky-dory and good, and you'll have times when you lean into your prayer because you have a specific need. And that is pretty much the typical walk for most pretty good Christians. The ones that really stand out are the ones that bring the battle to the enemy directly. Those are the ones that Satan hates. Those are the ones that the demons are afraid of. And that is the power and the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ that was given to us. We are not to sit back and put our hands over our heads and dig a foxhole and hide while everybody else is taking bullets. All right, we're supposed to be out there taking these entities down. All right, and praise God. But when you're doing that, you're also going to get attacked. And so, you know, you'll have these periods of time where everything seems like it's okay, and you're like going, oh, thank you, Father, thank you, Father, thank you, Father, and you're just like, praise God. But then, of course, you also have that dynamic where the idle mind is the devil's playground, so you really don't want to be too, like, not involved. You know, you always want to be busy, you know, serving God, reading the Bible, fixing things around your house, whatever the case may be. But my point is that you need to be looking, like, I don't want this to sound wrong, but metaphorically speaking, okay, you need to kind of, like, be aware. You need to be like looking over your shoulder, expecting an attack to come in. You need to be proactively praying against those attacks, okay, to be stifled, to be wiped out, to be eradicated, to be burned away and vaporized by the holy fire of God. We need to be doing that proactively as much as we possibly can, because when we are that big of a target, they're not going to give up. Listen, the demons and the witch covens, the members of the, you know, so when you're praying against live and dead human spirits, you're talking about the spirits that can astral project on behalf of Satan from witch covens. Now, don't, I'm telling you, if you are doing serious spiritual warfare prayers, if that is a part of your life, and you don't think that you are a target of a witch coven in your local town, I would submit that you're probably mistaken about that. Okay, that it is highly likely that you are a direct target. Satan hates people like that, and he does assign people on witch covens. And one of the reasons why he will assign people that are members of witch covens to come after you, okay, and astral project and do all kinds of, you know, they attack you. They attack you from many different ways. They go after your job. They're going to try to make somebody swerve on the road or pull out in front of you so you have a car accident. That's why we have to be, you know, driving defensively, living defensively, looking over your shoulders, expecting them to try to attack you is a very wise way to live when you are bringing the war to the devil and making his life miserable. Praise God. And that's what we need to be doing. And we need to be prepared to be able to do that, because as the days grow darker and we're going out in groups, you know, when no man can work, if we're still here, we're going to have to be prepared to and know how to come against that darkness and know how to be prayed up. Praise God. But anyway, hopefully that's a little bit meaningful to you. But yeah, we got to really – know how to pray, pray proactively, and pray for one another. And not just, you know, not just for the lost. That's a big, big thing. I mean, we should be praying for the lost every single day. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And have a big old prayer list. Sometimes your prayer list will get so big you have to lift them up in groups. Say, dear Heavenly, because I have a group, I call it the 400 list. It actually has more than 400 people on it. And they all have different issues and things that they're struggling with. And sometimes due to lack of time, I may not be able to sit there and mention every single, why, you know, I can't, I've even shared the list with other saints to get them to help me pray for people, because I can't cover all the names individually, but I will lift it up to the Lord. Anyway, so it's all part of our lives. We have to be on guard. We have to watch what's, you know, because right now, anybody who doesn't think that the darkness is, you know, that the hordes of hell have been released upon the earth, these are things that have been prophesied, by the way. Okay. There's this kind of weird time warp thing. Okay. There's this weird, I don't really understand it. Now, I do like to use the analogy, you know, based upon 1 Kings 22:19, where Micaiah sees, you know, they call them spirits, you know, just men made perfect, you know, Hebrews 12:22, that kind of thing, an innumerable company of angels, but in this case, it's actually minor gods, okay, and they're surrounding our Heavenly Father, and Micaiah, you know, says how you know, he petitions them, and he says, hey, all you guys, I want to hear your ideas on how we can go get, you know, King Ahab to go die at Ramoth Gilead. All right. And then one speaks in one way and one speaks in another. And then one of them steps forward and says, I know, I will become a lying spirit in the mouth of all of his prophets, which, by the way, is the definition of a seducing spirit, which we have like bazillions and bazillions and bazillions of seducing spirits, which have been sent down from our Heavenly Father. And you might say, well, our Father is not the author of confusion and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, that, no, it's not that. It's because it's part of his perfect design. This is part of the perfect design of the times that we were in right now, because our Heavenly Father needs us to draw in closer to him at an individual level. Because what happens, and I'm raising my hand, guilty as charged, what happens in our walk is that we will latch on to a small handful of people who we think are anointed. I see it. I've seen it my whole life. I'm going to be 59 in March, and I'm here to tell you, I've seen it my whole life. I can name names. I can name lots of names. I can name dozens of names, and I can name the names of the people that they follow. And what we do, and it's a bad practice. It's an awful bad practice. What we do is we latch on to somebody that we think is anointed, and then we believe that everything that they're saying is, well, you know, coming from God. That's a big mistake. We should never do that. What we ought to do is be squinty-eyed and suspicious of anything that is spoke, particularly now, you know, because I have never seen such, and I've mentioned this many times, I was very reliant, as everybody knows that has been around with this program since 2011 when I first started doing this, middle of 2011 when we launched a radio show. I used to quote Amos 3:7 all the time, surely the Lord God does nothing without first revealing it through his servants and prophets. But it wasn't until later, after years and years and years of, you know, collecting prophecies, sticking them in Word documents to the point where I have like 1,300 pages of prophetic words that I have not just read, but I've studied them and played them and even brought many of them on the program and had, you know, and personal friendships with them and such. And, you know, over time. And so, you know, and my memory is good. So I can remember like little details of different things that people have said, and it becomes a catalog. It becomes a portfolio of information that I believe that at least to a pretty good extent that I can trust. Okay, what started to happen, though, is there was this shift around 2016, right around when Trump got in, you know, into the presidency, and it's surprising. I guess it shouldn't be so surprising that was also when Obama, Fauci, and Gates were manipulating the whole Wuhan thing and getting ready, you know, just a few months before 2016, handing over the $3.7 million, moving the bioweapon from Fort Detrick over to the Wuhan lab to prepare for this massive assault against humanity. It is not genocide. Genocide is when you attack a particular race of people. People don't understand their terminology, and they'll say, that's genocide, a cry against mankind. No, it's not. Genocide is when you are killing a group, a specific group, like you're killing off, people from Slovakia or something. That's genocide, or whatever, or Somalians or whatever. That's genocide. Okay, this is just outright global murder. This is Nuremberg trial stuff. This is Operation Paperclip, eugenics on steroids, What should we assume? What should we estimate? And it all seemed to unravel. Isn't it fascinating, really, when you think about it? 2015, just to Sister Diana's revelation, 2015 was the moment. That was the year, when you think about it. So imagine 2015, the biblical blood moon tetrad, which everybody made a fuss about. John Hagee wrote a book about it. You know, Jim Baker has like guest after guest after guest after guest. You know, blood moon, blood moon, blood moon, blood moon. Everybody's talking about blood moon. And everybody's expecting the sky to fall, like, you know, 3 days after the final blood moon on September 15th to 20. September 23rd, I think it was, of 2015, something like that. The last one occurred, and super blood moon, I think they call it. But anyway, and everybody's expecting the sky to fall immediately. That's how we are. We're a Burger King generation. But there's always this delay. But isn't it, isn't it fascinating? And hold on a second, let me get myself so I don't run in circles, because sometimes when I have to take my Klonopin, not Klonopin for you people out there, because I know a lot of people say, no, Johnny, don't take Klonopin, it'll kill you. It's some kind of strange psychological, manipulation, mind control thing. Don't do. No, it's Klonadin. And it's an extremely awesome blood pressure med that works very, very well for people that have my situation. But anyway, so the time delta is a very hard thing for us to deal with, because we are, the Burger King generation. Have it your way, pickles, lettuce, don't upset us, whatever. Right, kids? That kind of thing? You guys hungry? Oh, man. The time delta thing is hard. I like to use the analogy that our Heavenly Father can have a meeting like he had in 2 Kings, in 1 Kings 22:19, that Micaiah saw. He can have a meeting like that. He can have 1,000 of those meetings by the time we can eat a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. Okay? Because that's exactly how it works. I don't think anybody, how could we possibly pretend or claim to understand the dynamics and the deltas associated with our Heavenly Father's realm and his, eternal ness, okay, in that realm of operation, as if we were to put them side by side. Chuck Misler took a shot at it. He says, God, it's kind of like looking down on a parade route. He can see the beginning of the parade and he can see the end of the parade. He can see all the different things that are happening in the parade. But, kind of like a helicopter view of a parade route. And that's kind of cool. I like that analogy. That's pretty neat. I prefer to think of it a little bit differently. The eternal realm, and I don't really understand the why part, and that's okay. And I don't know if I even care about the why part. But one thing is for sure, it operates in like super duper duper high speed. Okay, so you have to imagine the eternal realm as compared to our realm occurs like I said, 1,000 meetings with an innumerable company of angels and just men made perfect and minor gods in heaven, to discuss the war footing that our Heavenly Father is on, because he has lifted his hand of protection off of the earth and he's allowing things to happen. The blood moons have taken place. The Fort Detrick has moved the bioweapon creation and manipulation of the COVID, over to Wuhan. I heard that they're juicing Wuhan back up. They're torching that thing back up. They're refunding it and everything now under Biden. Okay, which is no surprise to me, because we got, after all, we can't go too long without another bioweapon release, can we? So anyway, we'll see. We'll see. But we know that they're teeing things up. I mean, they've got a queue of attacks that they're going to try to bring down on mankind. They're not going to lose momentum unless our Heavenly Father stops it, which I pray against. I pray in the name of Jesus that we keep this momentum going and that it accelerates. Okay, that's what we were brought to earth for. That is what our mission on this earth is. So when to circle back to that thing where we get sad and we get bummed out, and we need to be able to deal with these bummed out things better, okay, is is this would be what I'm trying to accomplish in my walk. And it's hard. It's really, really hard because we're all kind of, you know, we do what we do. And one of the things that we do do, kids do do it. So you're like, I knew you would like that. I knew you would like that. But anyway, one of the things that we do do is that we get, you know, we see something happening in our lives and we get all bummed out about it. Our husband's behaving a certain way and it's really depressing us. Our kids are acting a certain way. We're praying for them, but we're not seeing the results. We get sad. Something bad is happening on our work front. You know, Smith Wigglesworth, what an excellent example. Smith, when he would travel around, and he was like, he had to get on like these ocean liners. That's how he traveled from country to country, on ocean liners. And there were times when he, all he had, you know, all he had was the ticket to get on the ocean liner and maybe a little tiny bit of pocket cash for something to eat. That's it. And he would be standing, you know, there was one particular time he was in Australia and he was supposed to be getting on an ocean liner and something happened and they didn't, I guess he had like a will call ticket or something. And he went up to the little booth or whatever to get his ticket to get on the ocean liner and they didn't have it. It wasn't there. So Smith, who walked in incredible faith and was so strong in his faith with God, which of course anybody who has seen the miracles that Smith Wigglesworth saw would develop that faith. See, we're at a disadvantage because if we're not seeing a continuous flow of many miracles in our lives, or we're seeing none, heaven forbid, that puts us at an extreme disadvantage because we don't have anything to jack up our faith. We need to have our faith jacked up. It's just how it is. Okay, and so, and sometimes that takes just a concerted action on our part. We always want to believe that some supernatural outpouring is going to fall upon us and we're going to be double anointed and wake up and we're just going to be glowing in the mirror, full of Jesus, dancing in the rain. Hallelujah. Praise you, Father, speaking in tongues, spinning in circles. I can't wait to get to work and witness to people and go to HR and get fired. But anyway, the point is, We have to identify those things that are bumming us out, and we've got to, if we can look at ourselves as God looks at us. See, that's the hard part. This is what I would call a part of renewing of our mind. Renewing of our mind, I think, is probably one of the more misunderstood things in the Bible. I'm not saying that it isn't a combination of supernatural effects upon our lives through prayer, through the presence of angels, through anointings that can come from the Holy Spirit. I think it's all of the above. I do. However, I also believe that there is little that is 100% only God. I believe that our walk, and boy, oh boy, is there evidence to back this, including scriptural evidence, experiential evidence, things that people have been through, things that if we look back on our lives, it's undeniable. The court's adjourned. This is a fact. It's always a combination of the supernatural combined with us doing something as well. Okay, so we oftentimes just want to toss everything at the foot of the cross, take no responsibility for how we feel, how we behave, how we're acting, our emotions, whatever the case is, and we don't renew our mind. We don't take any responsibility for the renewing of our mind. We just say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I need help with this. And the other thing, I've tossed it before the foot of the cross, and I'm just going to expect a miracle. But we don't do nothing. And then we go to work and we get beat up again. We're not praying spiritual warfare prayers. We're not asking for SEAL Team 7 angels. We're not asking for backups. We're not asking for holy fire. We're not doing any of those things. And even if you are, you still have to renew your mind. You have to take some ownership in the renewing of your mind. Now, I am a big, you know, fan of surrounding myself with positive thinking. And I've talked about this before. I like to memorize positive thinking. I have little apps on my phone that I use and I page through them. I don't care if they claim that Buddha thought of it because that's a bunch of balderdash anyway. They can put as many pictures of Buddha on those things as they want to. It is irrelevant and it is a lie from the devil because if you know your Bible well enough, you'll be able to find whatever witticism or positive word that you're reading, regardless of who they give it credit for. You can find it in the Bible. Bible came first, period, end of story. They give credit to these entities because they don't know any better. And that's okay. But you can still benefit by the wisdom, and hopefully with a little bit of reading of Proverbs and Psalms and things like that, and dwelling in the New Testament and stuff, you'll be able to pick up, and you will supernaturally and spiritually relate to that positive witticism, that positive thing. You know, every day I wake up is the beginning of my life. I love that one. Every day. Now, I could go back and quote you, you know, there's a scripture, I think it's in Proverbs, I'm not exactly sure, but it goes something, we've all heard it, you know, a crying will happen in the night, but joy will come upon us in the morning. Now, why is that? And it's kind of true. All of us have kind of lived it, right? You know, you're like, oh, man, I'm so depressed. I can't take it. The stress, the anxiety. They've thrown all this stuff at me at work. I am not prepared for this. Nobody's offering me any help. I'm in a vat of boiling oil. What am I going to do? What am I going to do? You can't sleep. And you're tossing and turning and rolling. And oh, my gosh. And this, that, and the other thing. And or my kid is doing this, and my kid is doing that. They're going to get arrested. What am I, you know? And then I'm going to have to bail them out of jail. I'm going to mortgage the house, you know. And the stuff. And then the next day, for some reason, we wake up and we have some kind of peace. Why is that? Well, there's also scriptures, if you know your Bible well enough. And again, I don't memorize everyone a chapter and verse, but I read a lot of them. And I remember them. And, you know, and I can paraphrase them, but I can't quote all of them directly. But there's also another one that says that our Lord, our Heavenly Father, ministers to us, or, the Lord ministers to us. The Lord is just a way of saying Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and the Godhead and the power from heaven above and all that, and angels and the whole deal. Okay. You know, kind of like he that restrains is taken out of the way in 2 Thessalonians 2. It's the whole gamut. It's the whole deal. It's the whole package. All right. It's the prayers of the saints. It's everything. All right. It's not just one thing. Everybody wants to just nail it down to one little thing. No, it's not. It's the whole deal. It's the power. Thank you, Jesus. It's the glory. All right. But renewing of your mind is, it takes action on your part. You know, you need to identify where your weaknesses are. And one of the things, and work on those weaknesses. You got to work on them. You know, maybe your diet is dorked up. You ever think of that? You know, you are what you eat. And, you know, and I know people coin that phrase a lot, but you are. You are what you eat. And if you're eating poorly and you're just pounding out Snickers bars every day, and you know what? Is that abusing your temple body? See, I didn't think of that. You know, I used to pound down Snickers bars all the time. I didn't care. I was 360 pounds of what? I was like, whatever. You know, what do I care? I'm not looking, you know, to be anything but, you know, belong to Jesus. I'm not looking to go out on a date or anything like that. So praise God, you know. So I just sat around eating Snickers bars. But now looking back and in retrospect, I don't really think I was doing the temple body any good. Matter of fact, I was probably bringing on type 2 diabetes without even realizing it. So, but anyway, here's maybe something that'll be helpful. It has helped some people that I've talked to. It is helping me a little bit. When we are able to understand how God sees us, it changes things because it's not how we see ourselves. Now, I talk about this and I quote the scriptures to support it on the prayer vigil routinely because I don't think we can hear it enough. But when you move to that next level in your walk through sanctification, seeking the Lord, and you get to this place where you're starting to spiritually discern the scripture, and all of a sudden you realize that there are paradoxes, but those paradoxes have reasons for their existence in the scripture, and they help us to grow. And it's complicated, but I do cover this periodically in different programs and stuff with examples. But the key here to understanding is to recognize, however you wish to recognize it, it's up to you. If you want to accept the fact that, you know, that we are those who are in Psalm 82, that we, you know, understanding predestination, getting into those kinds of concepts, the election process, the election of grace, which I've talked about, and it's in Romans chapter 11, verse 5. I think it's 5. It's, if not, look a couple verses further down, the election of grace, which is very cool, super cool stuff. Which, by the way, supports the fact that some of us have been chosen for specific missions here on the earth. Now, let's go beyond that for just a moment. Let's set that aside because that's just fact. It's in the Bible. It is what it is. All right. Now, that being said, now look at 1 Peter 2:9. You are a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood. You are a royal priesthood. Now you go back to the Old Testament, you can study Levitical priesthood. Well, Levitical priesthood and the priesthoods of those times and the priesthoods in the New Testament as well. The role of a priest in the Bible is to remit sins, essentially, is to pray for the forgiveness of sins, and they would, you know, kill animals and stuff like that for the remission of sins and all that kind of stuff. All right, well, listen, that when you understand that you are a royal priesthood, you got to look at yourself. This is hard to do, and this comes along with renewing of your mind. And by the way, this also helps you get through the problems and those fiery darts that the darkness is shooting at you, sometimes directly, sometimes indirectly, sometimes through family members, sometimes through your job, sometimes through your car breaking down at the doggonest rottenest time. Okay, but whatever the case may be, okay, when you realize you got to look at yourself as a supernatural being, which we are inside. Our spirit man is a supernatural being. In fact, it communes with the Godhead. Romans 8:26 says, likewise, the spirit also helps, the spirit in us also helps with our weaknesses, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. It is not talking about speaking in tongues. That is not talking about speaking in tongues. That is incorrect. That is the Spirit of the living God, Jesus in us, the Holy Spirit operating through us, the Godhead operating through us. Okay? So when you understand that, when you can disconnect from the earth, become a citizen of heaven, Ephesians 3:20, Philippians 3:20, sorry. I think so. It's either or. But when you understand that we are citizens of heaven, that we operate in the courtrooms of heaven, that that which is bound on earth is bound in heaven, that which is loosed on earth is loosed in heaven, how can that possibly be? How can Hebrews 12:22, how can we be standing before an innumerable company of angels? How can we have been brought to Mount Zion, the city of the living God, to the heavenly Jerusalem? How can we exist there? How can we be operating there? It is impossible to be doing it. No, it's not. Oh, no, it's not. When you understand that you are really not here, you are, but you're not. Your spirit operating in the Godhead with the authority and power of the Lord Jesus Christ, communing in that priesthood state, needs to understand how to disconnect from the temporal. The Bible refers to it as the temporal world. Okay, that's the world that we see around us, which, by the way, the Bible basically says is temporary. It's a, you know, it doesn't call it a hologram, but, you know, for all intents and purposes, it is a kind of hologram, as Einstein said, albeit a very convincing one, which it is. But when you operate knowing that you were sent here from above, predestined, as a royal priesthood, your walk to become that royal priesthood might have been a long, hard walk. But when you finally come to that revelation, you need to be able to disconnect. You need to not take those things personally. You need to look at them as who you are. When your husband or your wife or whatever are driving you up a wall and you're just like ready to pull your very last hair out of your head. You've got to renew your mind. You've got to do your part. You've got to remember who you are. You've got to understand that you are a supernatural. You are a part of the Godhead. You are a royal priest. All this stuff that's happening around you is just stuff. When you can disconnect from it and not become emotionally drugged down into the pit because of the things that are happening around you and raise above it, knowing that, hey, it's just circumstances that God has utter and absolute control over, that divorces you from the emotions that will suck you into the pit and make you ineffective. And oh my gosh, guess what? That's the time that you need to be the most effective of all, is when you're getting sucked down into that pit. So we need to keep on reminding ourselves who we are. Disconnect from the darkness that's pulling at you. Don't let it drag you down. Remember who you are. Operate in the courts of heaven. Praise God, because praise creates a supernatural stargate of power, a wormhole of connectivity directly to the throne room. Hallelujah. It scatters the darkness in all directions. It is one of the most powerful ways to allow the authority of Christ to move through you is through praise. But we forget. Because we get sucked into that pit. We have to renew our minds. We have to know who we are. We have to become it. And when we can become it, we can disconnect from it. And when we can disconnect from it, it doesn't have any power over us. Get it? That's where I am. I have to get better at that. Okay, physician, heal thyself, like Jesus said. I personally have to get better at that because, you know, my blood pressure shoots through the roof because I get assigned things. And then I got to remember, wait a minute. Isn't God in control? You know, I had to put a little sticker on my sign. I remember every time I've had a conversation with a believer, whatever the circumstances may have been over the last, you know, X number of years, bunches of years, decades, I remember little things that they say because I know that if God speaks to a mule, he's going to speak to our kids, he's going to speak to our employers, he's going to speak through everything, through road signs. But you got to be paying attention. You got to be walking in the spirit. You got to be feeling the input. You got to know that you're in a hologram. And then you can sense it, and it becomes part of your walk. And somebody said to me at one point, I was like so overwhelmed with stuff, and the person said, just look at it like a challenge. And I sat there and I thought to myself, man, I'm a Humpty Dumpty. I am a big, dumb Humpty Dumpty. You know, when you realize who we are on this earth, we realize that we're going through this hologram. We're going through this because this is conditioning us. It is training us. This is our boot camp. This is preparing us to rule and reign with Jesus as kings and priests over all of creation. And we have to go through this training. The question is, when you go through the training, are you doing it with grace, faith, and understanding who you are? And disconnecting so you don't get sucked down into the well of ugly. Because then you're ineffective, and the fear, the anxiety, and all the other stuff that comes along with that struggle, that becomes something that the darkness can feed off of. So you're actually empowering the darkness to continue their attack against you because you're not disconnecting. You're forgetting that you're a royal priest. You're forgetting that this is a hologram, a training ground. You're not looking at it as a challenge. Doesn't mean that you don't ask for prayer from the saints. You do. That's what makes us powerful. It increases our power. You know, it's like Scotty on the Starship Enterprise. I need more power. The dilithium crystals are starting to dim. Captain, you know, we need to join together in prayer. We need to reach out to our fellow believers and not just in praise. But we also got to renew our mind. We've got to disconnect and we got to know who we are. And that is so important for us to embrace, to learn, and to put into action right now. Because look at the stuff that's happening across the world. Even though they are saying, the entities are saying that the COVID numbers are dropping, we can't trust anything. We can't trust anything that they say. We already know that, okay? But it doesn't matter. All that does is it enlightens us to the potential for something else that they're planning to bring against us. Okay, and we should be always squinty-eyed and looking at it and suspicious and kind of peeking under the covers. So I'm just going to leave it at that. I just hope that this is helpful because that's very hard to do. But I will tell you this, there is nothing more that will set you free in your walk powerful than that. Is to know that you are a royal priesthood, that you operate in the courts of heaven, that the Godhead power moves through you and your prayers, and that the things that are happening around you, our Heavenly Father will allow those things to happen because He is conditioning us, He is training us, He is refining us. And when you can make that separation, knowing who you are, disconnect the plug from the events that you see happening around you and take it before the courts. Lift and rise yourself up to where our Heavenly Father sees you, not where you see yourself. And now all of a sudden, all those things that drag you down fade off And the face of Jesus shows up. And his hand on your shoulder. And that changes everything. Praise God. And naturally, I went over time as I always do. So let's go ahead. I'm sure that we have Brother Gary hanging in there. Hang in there for me, Brother Gary. We don't have a lot of news, but we're going to hit the news as fast as we can. And then we'll bring you on live. I love bringing you on the show, brother. You're awesome. Praise God for you. Thank you, Jesus. All right. So I wanted to share this with you. Let's go ahead and go into the news real quick. I don't think we'll be doing the news for much more than 10 minutes. So hang in there for me, Gary. And then we'll go live with you. And we can go on to 10:30. So we got plenty of time. All right. Praise God. So, and don't feel you have to use all the time. But if you feel led, you can use it. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. And let's go into the news. Here we go.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please?
It's not normal.
It's just wrong.
What? It's not normal.
This is disturbing.
Game over.
All right. Praise God. And one last thing regarding the time delta. We're seeing today most, not all, but portions of the prophecies that we were collecting back in 2011, 2012, 2013, especially 2013 was a big prophecy year. We're seeing, I have many of them printed out, and I have a file folder. I actually file them away and reference them and highlight them and all that. We're seeing a lot of those things coming true right now. Just remember, Blood Moon, we thought nothing was happening. Obama, Fauci, Gates. Bioweapon moved from Fort Detrick over to Wuhan, $3.7 million given them to create the bioweapon right after the Blood Moon, right around the time that the Blood Moon was occurring. And now look where the world is. Make no mistake, we have been jettisoned forward. The question is, does our Father keep the momentum working on behalf of the kingdom? Or does he have a divine vision that we don't understand? And then we just have to deal with a lull, if there is a lull, between the birth pangs. And then we just have to deal and praise him for it anyway, because we don't understand. But I believe that Diana was touched. I believe that when the Lord told her that the saints are to raise up a petition, that God is asking our Father to continue forward with the judgments, I believe that that was anointed. Because if we lose momentum now, I mean, I have people at work that I would have guessed beyond any shadow of a doubt were unbelievers. And now they're actually private contacting me and asking me, what is going on? How can this be happening? And then I find out they're believers. So the Lord is allowing me and many of us to touch other people. And if we lose that momentum and everything goes back to this new normal that they talk about or whatever, then that's not going to be ideal. We want to keep that momentum moving in whatever fashion our Father's will is, because if it turns into another 9/11 and everybody goes back to sleep, it's not going to benefit the kingdom. It's not. And so it is a righteous prayer, and it is in alignment with our Heavenly Father's will. And again, I can sit here and quote scriptures all day long. At midnight, I will rise to give thanks to you because of your righteous judgments. That's in Psalms, I think, 119, verse 16, I think. I'm not sure. There's so many. And so we need to keep that momentum. We need to keep our prayers. We need to be on our toes. There's a delta, a time delta. It's amazing to me that 2013, I'm actually, it's like reading newspapers now when I look at the prophecies that came out in 2013. They're actually happening now, a lot of it. Praise God. So, the news. Praise God. Listen to this. Hallelujah. Here we go. This is from The Hill. Highly well considered by, you know, the earthlings. Law enforcement officials lay out evidence Capitol riots wasn't a coordinated attack. Now, I would play the Thank You, Captain Obvious bit, because to us it ought to be Thank You, Captain Obvious. Anybody who doesn't know that that was agent provocateurs, you know, they had mind control towers up, the whole deal. I mean, the facial recognition systems to impeach people and try to falsely imprison them. It was a setup. But what's really cool is the law enforcement officials are going before Congress and telling them, we have all this evidence and it strongly indicates that this was a pre-planned, orchestrated, you know, event. And I'm like, great. Matter of fact, I'm going to download this one video I got. I'm going to plug that up on the one of the sites where on my website where I have the absolute beyond any shadow of a doubt video proof that they were using crisis actors, and the woman that was supposedly shot in the neck never died at all. It was all faked. All right, praise God. So, and that's how they do it. That's just how it works. Praise God. Next one up. Listen to this. Pfizer is demanding bank reserves, military bases, and embassy buildings as collateral for COVID-19 vaccines. You know, if I was the leaders of these different countries, I'd tell Pfizer to get out of my country and never come back. Especially because it's a bioweapon to solve a bioweapon. Who wants to take a bioweapon to solve a bioweapon that creates autoimmune disease? I mean, you know, and then they have plausible deniability because 2 years from now you get Hodgkin's lymphoma and it was caused by the daggone vaccine. For crying out loud. Thank you, Jesus. And I want to give this is very important. All right. Hallelujah. So I wanted to give you some good news. Now, there's a lot of people that can't receive it, and I understand that. All vaccines have stuff in them we don't like. We don't want them to be there. It's part of what they call adjuvants. They have to put stuff in there. I don't think they have to put what they put in there. I think some of their choices are pretty seeding evil, if you ask me. And the aluminum salts will lodge into your brain and increase your odds of Alzheimer's eventually. If you're protected by the word of the Lord, come on. Luke 10, verse 19, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Mark 16:16, 16:17, and 18, and they will drink anything deadly and will by no means hurt them. That's ingest, by the way. That's what that word means. It means to ingest. Okay. So we don't really have anything to worry about. All right. But I'm just saying, I wanted to give the good news. The people, when we had the man on the show from Johnson & Johnson, and he said that their teams of doctors and scientists were actually praying, which I thought was just awesome. Well, it turns out that they have done some additional testing, and they have found out, at least this is what the FDA claims on a recent report, that not only – see, so at first it was coming out with low scores, like, oh, it's only 60%, but it's one jab, blah, 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 and you can do it in hot climates. It doesn't have to be – and all that. So they were kind of downplaying its significance, but there was a new press release that just got released on the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, which is nothing more than a regular seasonal flu type vaccine. Get this. They have officially announced that it actually prevents a person from getting COVID-19. So at first, it was just like it reduces the symptoms should you get it or whatever the case is. Now they're coming out with the FDA stamp of approval and stating publicly that it prevents people from getting it, completely stops it. Now, granted, I wish they'd take some of the adjuvant stuff out of there. I don't like it. I'm not going to get into it. I wish they didn't use it, but they do. And I I don't blame anybody for saying, I'm not volunteering for diddly. Okay. But for those people that are in countries where they're planning on destroying your life if you don't have it, again, I'm telling you, folks, Israel, many stores can't even enter unless you can prove you had. So, I mean, for people that have no choice, what an awesome option. Praise God. And to find out that the actual scientists and executives at Johnson & Johnson were praying over it at the time that they were working on it. I think that is awesome. A lot of people cannot receive it. As a matter of fact, as we get more and more advanced in our understanding of the scripture and who we are in Christ, more and more people who profess Jesus as their Lord will drop out because they can't receive it. Oh, I thought everybody at NASA was of the devil. Oh, I thought everybody that was in that particular church denomination was of the devil. Oh, I thought that everybody at... No, it's not how it works. It's just not how it works. Anybody who thinks an organization that has 115,000 people working for it thinks that every one of them is a Satan worshiper, you really got to examine your logic. All right, praise God. All right, next one up. Federal Reserve Payment System. Listen to this. This is significant. Federal Reserve Payment System services restored after massive disruption. Okay, and they go blah, blah, blah. Our services are restored, and they name all the different services that were interrupted. Fed ACH, Fed Cash, Fed Line Advantage, Fed Line. There's got to be like 10 or 15 of them that they're mentioning that were all taken down. Now, they're just claiming that it was just kind of like a burp and, no big deal, blah, blah, and that kind of thing. But what if they're covering up the most likely cause, which would be a cyber attack? Buckle up, folks. Lots of prophetic words about things along that line. And by the way, as far as critical infrastructure is concerned, one of the most vulnerable parts of the United States is critical infrastructure is what we saw happen in Texas. And no, it's not some kind of bioweapon harp attack. And no, it's, it just, when people go out there and they say those kinds of things, which they are, what it does is it calls into question those of us. See, we're all clumped together into this big category to make us all look like a bunch of, Donald Ducks, and to ruin any chance of credibility. And then you got people coming out there and saying things that they should not be saying. And it's simple. I've covered it many times. But anyway, listen to this headline. Monster Arctic front engulfs Asia. It wasn't just Texas. It was also Asia. It was also Canada. It was all across Europe. I mean, the places of the world. We're talking about minus 58 degrees Fahrenheit. These are records that are being set. This is not cyclical. I've talked to some really smart people that ought to know better, but they're not. They're buying the baloney, and they're going, when I was a kid, I had to dig my way out of the house. No, this is not that. I mean, even the meteorologists are going, when does this happen? I actually have those reports. I just can't, I'd have to have like 12-hour shows and just talk. I could probably do it, but I'd have to quit my job, and then the power would go out, and I wouldn't have a internet, and all that kind of doggone domino stuff. Praise God. Next up. AccuWeather reports Dallas sees an 80 degree plus temperature swing in 1 week. And I'll speak for the meteorologist. When does this happen? It happens when you are rapidly jettisoning into the very end of times. We haven't checked off all the Olivet Discourse boxes and all of the 2 Thessalonians 2 boxes, and we certainly haven't gotten to where, the end of the third seal where do not touch the oil or the wine, which is a direct reference to the bride of Jesus Christ. So we've got to figure we're going to be here for the global financial collapse for sure. Okay? Just estimate that. I would think that's reasonable. And none of those things are happening yet, but we are checking the box. And some of the boxes we're putting little circles in because they're in progress. Okay. And remember, when you lay seals out on the table, Jesus can come along and pop the seals. Seal number one, seal number two. Pop, 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 pop. And then the scrolls with all the things that happen can roll out in parallel. In parallel. So keep looking around you, folks, because it's all starting to happen. Next up. EPA approves chemical air treatment. Listen to this. The EPA approves a chemical aerosol treatment to spray in the air against COVID in spite of its known health hazards. Kind of like Agent Orange. So we'll all be walking around with like four eyes on our forehead, limping, and, with Julian Barr syndrome and all this other stuff. It's like, thank you for disinfecting my office. Not. Ugh. Boy, this is an insane world. All right, hallelujah. Next one up. Investigating viruses and cells used to make vaccines. The evaluating the potential threat posed by transmission of viruses to humans. This is the title of a white paper that is currently posted on the federal the Food and Drug Administration. And this is by several scientists and peer-reviewed. And they are saying, hey, we are looking at all of these vaccines that have been used for the last several decades. And there are things in there that shouldn't be there. Cancer of many different kinds, cancer cells. And then they point out in the white paper, hey, these things could become active later on in life. And everybody's sitting around scratching their head, eating a banana, going, there sure has been a lot more cancer in the last 50 years than there used to be. It must be because, we're not eating. It's all Monsanto's fault. It's an onslaught from hell itself. The hordes of hell. Next up, Palestinian Islamic scholar. If Muslims want peace, they must get rid of the Jews. Boy, there's no surprise there. Thank you, Captain Obvious. I was on a totally different track. Next up, Samaria. River turns to blood red as Arabs bring plagues of Egypt upon themselves. And, well, no, it's actually worldwide. It's iron oxide dust. It's caused by Planet X. It's a giant magnet, and it's pulling iron oxide out of the Earth's mantle, and it's getting into the water supply. It is not blood. It is iron oxide. It is to be expected. Sign of the Son of Man, Matthew 24:29. Jeremiah the Destroyer, Jeremiah 4, verses 5 and 6. I do believe it is there. Sometimes I get my Jeremiah chapter and verses mixed up. Another one, Israel hit by worst environmental disaster in decades. Another headline, a new wave of desert locust invasions currently destroying crops and pastures in Kenya and threatening the livelihoods of millions of people, threatening to spiral out of control. And it mentions a whole bunch of other countries as well. So the locust plagues are continuing gangbusters. Another headline, praise God, police use tear gas against stone pelting protesters in India as rallies turn violent. Nothing new. It's happening all over the world. If you search on riots and protests and, you know, use DuckDuckGo, don't use Google, because they're censoring everything. DuckDuckGo.com, and you'll get some real trustworthy stuff. Or get Telegram, because it's all over Telegram. Hallelujah. All right, next one up. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Supreme Court, listen to this. Supreme Court dismisses slew of 2020 presidential election lawsuits. So all those Seven Mountains people that are all been going, Donald Trump's going to win. He's going to in March. He's going to go back into the White House. Yeah, you just wait and see. God told me this. I had lunch with Jesus the other day, and Donald Trump is coming back. Well, Supreme Court just took all their cases that they were willing to hear after January 20th, and tossed them all out. Another headline, Beijing records warmest February day since 1951. Another headline, more than 59,000 people flee as Dujuan brings widespread flooding and disruption to the Philippines. Philippines, China, Indonesia, all going underwater, and Brazil. Brazil, it's all over the world. It's just unbelievable. Hallelujah. Listen to this. Flesh-eating bug on the rampage in Australia with warnings of a link to mosquito bites. Could this be another one of those bioweapons, folks? They love to use vectors like mosquitoes. Remember Zika? Remember Zika? They were just practicing. All the bioweapons experts came out and said, yep, this has all the earmarks of a bioweapon. And I'm not going to tell you what I'm looking at right now. It's a picture of a little boy that got bit by one of these things. And it's just like that. It's bad. It's bad. Oh, by the way, another report out of the United Kingdom states that there was not a single case of the seasonal flu that was placed on record, not one, this year. The hundreds of thousands of them that are normally appear, they're not. Why? Because they were all marked as COVID. Euronews reports, Greece issues COVID vaccine certificates to those who had both doses. Here's your papers. I am the Gestapo, and you are not allowed to get on this freeway without your papers. Because, you know, you'll get in trouble from fatherland security. I'm sorry, homeland security. Oh, my goodness, I just get so mixed up. Fatherland, homeland. FEMA camps everywhere. What are we? Oh, my gosh. Wait, eugenics. It's like unbelievable. It just keeps on going. It just keeps on going. And where it stops, nobody knows. But we're going to go ahead and jump over to Brother Gary Wayne. Praise Jesus, because, boy, this stuff could just drag on forever. All this end time stuff. Get excited. And remember who you are. Disconnect. Royal priesthood. Royal priesthood. Praise God. Here we go. Glory to God. Brother Gary, are you there?
I am. I'm so happy to be back with you tonight and so much looking forward to what we're going to be talking about.
Great. Well, praise God. And I'm going to just defer to your expertise because, as I've mentioned every time we brought you on the program, your book is so deep and covers so much material, I can't, I mean, even if I read it, I wouldn't be able to recall enough information to have any kind of an intelligent dialogue. So I really just kind of have to turn the mic over to you and let you run with the ball. But you did mention some, I think, talking about how essentially these descendants of the giants ultimately have, you know, they have this master plan to enslave humankind. And I find that supernaturally relevant to this whole, I don't know, what they're calling Global Reset 2 or whatever. It used to be called the New World Order, but they, you know, they have to change the names so that they can confuse us and keep us off our game. But anyway, I'm just going to go ahead and turn it over to you, brother. So take it away, Gary. God bless you, brother. Thank you for joining us tonight.
Well, thank you so much. And I couldn't agree with you more on, you know, all the headlines that you were talking about, and as well as this all being connected to the giants and the complete global reset that they're going to try and bring about. So I thought tonight I would cover off my book in general. It's a large book, so we can't spend a whole lot of time on each chapter, but we're going to find a way to give people an idea what might be in this book, because I think this is a book that is rather unique. And it's written for the times that we're in, and to better understand what happened, what is happening, and what's going to happen. So the name of the book is The Genesis 6 Conspiracy, How Secret Societies and the Descendants of Giants Plan on Enslaving Humankind. And like I said, you won't find another book that has this kind of information that's in it. It's a 6,000-year connect-the-dots investigation into what I call the House of Dragon that begins in Genesis 6 with the sons of God, the angels who create these giants, and how the angels and the giants partner with the organizational structure that has come about underneath and before through the descendants of Cain and son of Cain, Enoch, with the mystical religion and the seven sacred sciences and the illicit knowledge that comes from the fallen angels to form the sun-worshipping bull cult of the antediluvian epoch religion, and the secret societies that come out of it to develop the sciences and the knowledge and to protect it from the mundane, the average humans. And all of this set up an organizational structure with the Nephilim kings usurping all of the kingships and imposing this universal religion. And so the book is going to cover that off in terms of how this paraded the antediluvian world into apocalypse, and then how this organizational structure, the people, the religions, the societies, and the giants show up after the flood, particularly coming together at Babel, and how they affected our history and what they're doing today to bring about the end time and the rendezvous with destiny that they want to bring on. So it's something that it's not that it's just going to be happenstance. They're going to play an active role in bringing this out because they want this showdown with God for good or bad. So the book has 98 chapters. As I mentioned, it's a very large book, and there's a ton of information in it. So it's designed so that you're not going to be able to speed read it, because there's just no loose chapters. There's no fluffy sentences. It's filled with information from chapter 1 right through chapter 98. But I wrote the book in a format where each chapter is a mini story that keeps coming up as the rest of the book unfolds and will come up several times as it's relevant. And the average chapter is about 5 to 6 pages. So you don't have to read a lot of chapters. You could read one chapter a night and keep coming back as you would like. So it's one of those books that you can't speed read because there's just too much information. You'll just get information overload. And I would advise people to read it as they can digest it, because, as I say, the information just doesn't stop coming at you. And as we go through the sections, there are 8 of them. And if you were to scan on my website at thegenesis6conspiracy.com, that's the Genesis 6 with the number 6conspiracy.com, you'll see a pretty impressive list of chapters and probably will raise a lot of interest points. And you'll be able to read a generous excerpt of every of each chapter, and you'll get a good feel whether or not it's a good book for you or not. So with all of that being said, we're going to move on to section one, and it's entitled The Antediluvian Epoch and the Age of Great Heroes. So what I'm going to do in the first section is I'm going to look at, in 13 chapters, the things that we know about out of Genesis and the things that we don't know about Genesis. As I start to link in information from different cultures and secret societies as context in terms of how they perceive those events, and understand that they have accountings that are of a parallel nature, and they look at it through a polytheist lens. So it's important to understand what they believe and what they're doing with those beliefs, not necessarily whether or not we 100% agree with what their conclusions are, what they believe, but we need to understand that. So it weaves in information from all around the world, and I let them speak for themselves in their own words so that there's no manipulation on the information that's being set out. So chapters 1 through 3 are the heroes of old, the daughters of Cain, and the sons of God. And I start out the book with talking about the heroes of old, and in some of the English translations it'll say mighty ones, and in other translations we'll use heroes. And I've used a modern translation for the book to try and sort of cross over and bring people in, because some people struggle with the King James Version Bible. So the book is written in a manner that it has a significant Christian slant, which I am, and I'm a Christian contrarian. And what that means is that I like to verify everything, including the Bible, and not just take what somebody else says about it or what somebody says is written about it. So I like to verify things myself. So in the heroes of old, I begin with the connection to superheroes and how all of the superheroes, if you start to think about it, are connected back to these ancient giants. And they were the demigods and the sons of God and of a human female, which is the same parallel story as what's told in Genesis. And I will cover off how and why we know these sons of God are angels as opposed to Sethites or the New Covenant sons of God. So I cover that off in detail. And that we arrive at the daughters of Cain being the daughters that are talked about in Genesis 6, 1 through 4, and that this cohabitation between the sons of God produces the giants. And we also get into the understanding of when these giants die, that their bodies may have died, but their immortal spirits do not. It's a counterfeit spirit that comes from the sons of God, and that they're not allowed to sleep, and they're not allowed to go into heaven. And these are the demons, as First Enoch talks about. And scripturally, if somebody were to get a hold of me, I have a lot of backup documents that I can walk scripturally through it, whether or not it's the sons of God or how we know demons are the evil spirits that Jesus dealt with in the New Testament. I'll walk you through that. Just get a hold of me through the website or at my email, genesis6conspiracy@gmail.com. So very easily to get a hold of me or through Facebook under Gary Wayne. And then chapter 4, we'll move on to describing what these giants were like, and that they had the giants that I'm going to cover off in the book. And I know there are other kinds of Nephilim. That'll be in my next book. But the main ones in terms of the government aspect and the main leaders in the armies for the warrior aspect were the serpent Nephilim from the Watchers or the Seraphim angels. So I'm going to cover off what they looked like. And I'm going to cover off giants just briefly at this point about like Og. And I'm going to connect these giants back to Greek mythology and Gigantes, which has that parallel heroes tradition and mythos that is in Greek mythology. And I'm also going to be talking about how these giants were, I'll demonstrate how these giants were not just sort of sideshow circus freaks. They were powerful warriors and very, very nimble and quick. So you'll get all of that. And I'll provide some of the meanings for the individual names of the many names that people may not be familiar with that giants are called in the Old Testament. So there's more than just Nephilim, and there's more than just Rephaim, and there's many, many names. And some of those names have some very interesting descriptions about them. And it sort of lines up with what's talked about in Isaiah and Ezekiel about the terrible ones. And again, just fascinating reading on it. And then chapters 5-9, it is about masonry and their view of prehistory. And most people understand that prehistory takes Freemasonry takes their history back to prehistory. So the chapters that we're talking about here are the Schism and Antediluvian Masonry, Enoch and Hermes, Enoch the Evil, and Royal Bloodlines. And the basic overall topics to what we're talking about here are how Masonry began, how Enoch fits into this, and understand there's two Enochs. So when you're reading through it, if you're getting a little bit concerned when I'm talking about Enoch, be patient, it'll come out. I'm going to talk about how Enoch is connected to Hermes, where the seven sacred sciences that were so much part of creating the mystical sun worship religion and the secret societies and the knowledge that would later merge with the fallen angels, how that was developed by Enoch, son of Cain, and that he wrote scripture as well for the polytheists. And he's one of those people that are conflated by polytheists to give them that sort of disguise that they can be out there with, and people think they're talking about Enoch, son of Seth. We're going to talk about the royal bloodlines of Cain, of Seth, and of the Nephilim, and why it's important to understand these bloodlines that are going to roll down through history of the royal families, and why we need to understand who those descendants are and what they're doing today. And chapter 10 is going to talk about the flood and connecting to how the giants caused the flood. And again, a testimony that comes from all around the world. And most people don't even realize that the creation of the giants in Genesis 6:1-4 is actually the preamble to the flood story. So we're going to cover that off so you have a direct understanding that the giants were the greatest cause to the corruption of the earth and the violence that was on the earth. And chapters 12 and 13 is entitled Azazel, Leader of the Watchers, and 13, Lucifer's Revenge. So I'm going to tie back in the main seven angels of the rebellion that brought the antediluvian world to its knees with the flood. And we're also going to talk in detail about Azazel and Shemyaza, and there's some very good information out there in terms of who they were and that they're likely the same angel. And that's part, maybe possibly one of the corruptions that came down through the years with the Book of Enoch, in terms of splitting them into two different angels. And Lucifer's Revenge is going to cover off the Eden Fall. It's going to cover off the Genesis 3 prophecy that I think is fulfilled in Genesis 6, and obviously the revenge of Genesis 6. And he has other revenges as well, but those are the first ones. And it sort of starts the whole book off with this information that is absolutely essential for the rest of the book. And then in section 2, it's called the Golden Age and the Golden Testimony for the Other Race, or the Global-Wide Testimony for Giants. And I'm going to cover off a lot of information that's in parallel through that polytheist lens, but it gives us important information in terms of the bloodlines that we need to be aware of, and again, the belief system that the polytheists have. So chapter 14 and 15 are grouped together, blackheads. Chapter 14, chapter 15, Isis, Ishtar, Gaia, and Ninkursag. And these are the parent gods that create the blackheads. And they have a couple different versions or attempts in doing this, as it happens in polytheism. But the blackheads are essentially the Sumerians that the people in the Bible of the Sethian line would have been living amongst, and including Noah. And we talk about the mother gods, or the parent gods, and the mother female god, which is a term that is going to come up in the end time universal religion. So it's important to understand who they are, and that there's lower gods or offspring gods that are also important that show up after the flood in terms of taking over. And chapter 16 and 17 is going to cover off, just so that, again, people have an understanding of why this has resonance that secular historians ignore for a purpose. These two chapters are going to cover off the worldwide flood myth and other connections that have this worldwide legacy that happens on all continents and all cultures and all around the world, and starting with the universal flood. And then it's going to move into chapter 17, which is a terrific parallel of Genesis, which is the Atlantis story. And the Atlantis story is about Poseidon and Cyane, who produced 10 Nephilim demigod kings to run the Atlantis Empire. And so I'm going to walk through that in detail and then show you some biblical parallels, particularly with the Atlantean sort of allegory to it as it's referenced in the Bible, and how it has an importance to end time Babel City and is sort of the prototype of, from an antediluvian basis, the Babylon religion. And then chapters 18 through 20 move on to talk about the first time in Egyptian history and everything that the Egyptians believed about it that connects right back and sort of extends from the Atlantean aspect. And then this understanding on polytheism about seven sages that are survivors from the flood, seven demigods or seven gods, and they teach human civilization from a polytheist view all of the knowledge that was lost with the flood, and they restart civilization. And these are the seven sages of Atlantis, Sumer, and Mu, and it's a worldwide tradition, so that we understand that they believe in more of a survival story than a second incursion aspect. Again, important to understand what they believe, because they'll take their bloodlines and their genealogy that's talking about these royal families around the world that usurped kingships and set up the feudal system that has basically dominated most of the time in our 6,000-year epoch from Adam to now, and what they're trying to reassert with the reset that John was talking about for the end time. And in chapter 21, we move on to the Epic of Gilgamesh. And the Epic of Gilgamesh I walk through so that people understand what they're using, the seculars and the polytheists are using to diminish the Noah story, that they're saying it was based on that. I'll talk about why that's not in the case, and then I'll get into the details to show you how it's a similar story on the macro level, but not on the micro level. So once you get into the details, this is a giant survivor story. This is not the Noah story. And what's also interesting in the Epic of Gilgamesh, with the creation of Gilgamesh, who is 6 to 7 feet wide and 16 to 19 feet tall after the flood, depending on whether you're using a common or a royal cubit, he is created after the flood. So what's also interesting about the Epic of Gilgamesh is that it has a survival story on an ark, and it also has second incursion, just as Anakeddon in Enkidu, as he's also called, is created after the flood to offset Gilgamesh's evilness. So it's interesting that they have two accounts on that, which will go into their belief system, which is really important. Then I'll back that up in chapter 22 with Deucalion, Manu, and Seth. And Deucalion is, again, the Greek Noah, but he's another Nephilim. Manu is the subcontinent of India, again, another Nephilim. And then Seth I introduce as Amaka Seth, which is another giant creation imagery that is talked about in Gnostic Gospels as a giant race before Genesis 6, and is this sort of first and primary giants that would be, I guess, equal, and maybe even from a religious perspective at a bit of a higher level that the Gnostics like to track their religion back to. So that's the first two sections. And then in section three, we're going to get into a lot of different things that's going to answer a lot of things for people about the Old Testament. And I get a lot of comments from people that are saying that for the first time they understand the Old Testament, and for the first time it makes sense, and that the Old Testament now starts to come to life. So it's important to cover this section off in the book because it sets up what happens with the development of the flood, the creation of the nation of Israel, and how things will eventually play out in the interaction because of the curses of the Holy Covenant being played out because Israel doesn't hold up their end of the bargain on the Holy Covenant. Whereas if they did, we would have had things fulfilled through the blessings in a completely different way. But God's Alpha Omega, so he gave them a choice, and everything is about free choice. And we're seeing that fulfilled. Not that Israel is forever condemned, because they're not. God remembers his covenant forever, but that'll play out in the end time as well. So as we open up section three, that's entitled The Descendants of Anak, Bloodlines and Blood Covenants, this is what we're going to be talking about. And so chapter 23 to 25 is going to cover off the Rephaim and the Amorites and Sodom and Gomorrah and the Amalekites and Jethro and Caleb. And in there, we're going to talk about who the Rephaim are as opposed to the Nephilim, and we're going to talk about the Amorite and hybrid humans as well as the giants, which are the Rephaim, and a number of these other giant tribes. And we're going to talk about some of the more important tribes like the Amorites and the Amalekites, and showing that these were hybrid humans with the Amorites and the Amalekites through Esau's line with Timnah and Eliphaz are going to produce Amalek. That's also a hybrid human line because Timnah's a Horim, one of the names of the giants that you'll learn about in the book. But yet the Amalekim, the Amalekites as they're called as in Genesis 14, predate the creation of Amalek, which is the tribe that is going to try and wipe Israel from the face of the earth. And we're going to talk about why, because it's got to do with inheriting the Holy Covenant as being a descendant of Esau. And all important in understanding these sort of context in terms of how that all comes about. And so we're also going to be covering off Sodom and Gomorrah in those series of chapters, and Abraham, who moves into the land of giants and hybrid giants, and how Sodom and Gomorrah is run by these Rephaim kings, and why Sodom and Gomorrah is a place where there's a likelihood of a second incursion, just as the polytheists believe, and that the polytheists do not believe Sodom and Gomorrah were evil cities. They believe it was a city of light, a city of knowledge, that the evil god of the Bible, as they would look at, our God as, destroyed knowledge and good people of light, as opposed to the wickedness and the evil things that we know that they did there. And I'm also going to cover off in there the War of the Giants in Genesis 14, and identify the giant nations that are in the covenant land as part of that, and as it connects with the other tribes that we see in the covenant land. So it's kind of interesting that really sort of set things going forward. And then I backtrack a little bit to give a little bit more information about the early post-Elevian period and what happens in chapters 26 through 30, that, you know, have chapters that are called, or 27 through 30 have, you know, chapter called Nimrod, the people of the plain, the Tower of Babel, and the original white brotherhood. And I'm going to cover off how the polytheists believe, and particularly Freemasonry, who takes their beginnings to re-emerging after the flood at Babel with Nimrod, and where the knowledge is given to Nimrod by another interesting figure that we cover earlier on in the book called Hermes. And this is the creation of the post-diluvian or after the flood original white brotherhood. And so we're going to look at how they look at Nimrod, the archetypical antichrist figure with the Babel allegory, which is for the universal religion of the end time, and how that sort of connects in important information for the latter parts of the book. In chapters 31 through 34, I'm going to talk about what happens with Israel as we move in through the Exodus and into the land of the covenant, and that the first start is not a good start. And they get scared off, and God has to put them through 40 years to forge their faith. And so chapters 31 is called Forging the Nation of Destiny. Chapters 32 are what I call the Nephilim Wars, and I'm going to cover those off. But in my next book, I'm going to be covering them off in all the different campaigns, which is will give extraordinary amount of detail. Just too much information to get into what is already a very, very large book. And chapter 33 is the Holy Covenant. And what's also bound into the Holy Covenant that's going to happen in chapters after this in terms of the war covenant that David and Saul are going to be obligated to do as they war against these giant nations, even after the conquest of the covenant land. And of course, chapter 34, I have a special chapter devoted for Jericho and why, and that was set aside for a special holy ritual as they entered into the promised land with the trumpets and walking around the city in a procession for 7 days. I'll cover that off in detail on how all of that information is related to giants and what they're about to do. And moving on from there, we move into chapters 35 through 38, which is the curse of the Amalekites. And I'm going to talk about again in detail, along with Esau's bloodlines, why it's important to understand why King Saul is going to be ordered to give them complete destruction. And it also, it all goes back to the Exodus. And then we're going to cover off chapter 36, King Saul and King David, in terms of how they come about and what their obligations from the covenant are, was to finish off the wars with the giants. And then David and Goliath have a special chapter on that with a lot of really good information in it as to why David took 5 stones. It's not that he didn't have faith. He was going to kill 5 kings of the Philistine Pentapolis. So you're going to get all kinds of information like that. And then chapter 38 is devoted to the Avites, or the Avim, who are the giants that lived also amongst the Philistines. And that in tracking who these Avim are, you start to understand who the other 4 giants that are notorious in Chronicles and Samuel that David and his mighty men take on. And all of this is vital information as how things are going to play out through history and into the end time. So in section 4, that is the terminal generation. And the book is now transitioning from what has happened in the past, and it's going to have a section now in terms of kind of what's going on today and the prophetic implications from this. And in chapter 39 through 44, I'm just going to bring people forward out of the past and connect a lot of dots. And the first one is nothing new is under the sun. So if we need to understand that concept that things happen over and over. Chapter 40 is the new man, which is a concept obviously out of Germany and what they're trying to do today with all the technology and cloning that they're doing. The new age of Aquarius, what that means in terms of how the polytheists look at it and the millennium that they're promising. The sign of Noah, and why it's important to understand what that sign is. And just as Jesus said, the end time is going to be like the days of Noah. That's, he's using, even though this is being translated into English out of Greek in the Old Testament is English from Hebrew. In Genesis 9:29, and only the Word of God could do this, he says, "And all the days of Noah," and he's talking about Noah living 950 years, 350 years after the flood, and 600 years before the flood, that we need to know this. This is an overarching sign over and above the godlessness and that people weren't expecting the flood, even though they were being warned. And so the sign of Noah that Jesus uses almost verbatim, which is amazing as it happens through two different languages being translated into English, is there for us to take note of and part of the end time sign. So, and part of that, when we look at what Jesus is talking about, we need to understand everything that happened, including Babel in the first 350 years after the flood, and what happened going into the flood with Noah and the giants. Just hugely important to understand that concept. And chapter 43 is the godless generation. So that's part of the signs of Noah, but we're going to talk about what the Bible talks about, the godless generation, and what that is, how that's being manifested, and what we see out there today. And then I'm moving into chapter 44, Babylon City, and I'm going to talk about how that is more than a city, more than a religion, also a geopolitical organization, and also a universal religion, and how the allegories out of the period before the flood, as in Atlantis, and the religion they had then is part of the allegory for Babylon that crosses the flood, and then how the Bible also uses three other allegorical cities for us to understand what Babylon is going to be like, one being Tyre, the other one being, another one being Nineveh, with the city of blood, and obviously Babylon City and Babel City, they, you know, for the religious aspect. So that sets up for what is the polytheist forces and the secret societies are going to be trying to bring about for the end time that is definitely on the horizon. We're definitely in the fig tree generation, I believe. So, and then I'm going to give a special chapter to in chapter 45 that's called The Reflections of the Third Reich, because that is kind of an exact kind of scenario that we can look upon as what the end time is going to be, that has all of the major elements. And that's because there's more than one Antichrist type figure that has been sponsored by what is called the spirit of the Antichrist. So in chapters 46 through 48, I've got chapters on the false prophet, disciples of light, the alien phenomena, how that connects in. And down in chapter 50, I've got the spirit of the Antichrist. And I'm jumping ahead on that just because of what I've touched on, because there's been a spirit of the Antichrist there all along, that Michael is there to prevent Antichrist from taking power. He's not there to stop the empire coming up. So he's not going to stop the end time empire, but he prevented, let's say, Nebuchadnezzar as being an Antichrist in full. He would have presented other kings of particularly the beast empires, whether or not it might have been Julius Caesar or Alexander. They're allowed to have their empires, but Antichrist wasn't allowed to take possession. And that's that spirit of the Antichrist that's always out there. So chapters 46 through 50 are going to cover off the false prophet and the disciples of light. And understand there's going to be false prophets and prophets from God, probably with the 144,000 and particularly with the two witnesses in the last 7 years. But expect these false prophets to show up before with prophets of doom. And I'm going to cover that off and end that with the mother of all sorceries. And that's that mother goddess aspect and a likely avenue in terms of how they're going to bring that all about through these false prophets and the mother goddess, the queen of heaven aspect. Just as Jeremiah talks about the queen of heaven, this is the same allegories and allegorized in both the parent gods and the offspring gods, whether or not it is a Sophia as a parent god in Gnosticism or Isis as an offspring god in the Egyptian religion. They're all talking about the same individual, the same allegory for the same type of gods. And so chapter 51, I'm going to spend specifically on Antichrist and things that we ought to expect and how he's being, how he's connected to the bloodlines of the giants. And as we move on in the book, I'm going to present that pedigree of his bloodlines that the polytheists have. And I'll talk a little bit more of that in the future. And then I'm going to talk about the rapture. And chapter 53 is an important one because it talks about Adonai. And Adonai is what secret societies, the Gnostics, call the God of the Bible. And Adonai means my Lord. So we're going to talk about that and how many times Yahweh is, I won't talk about that in the Bible, but you need to understand that when it's talking about the Lord in English translations, that's put in there for a reason, and it's replacing Yahweh. So it's an important piece of information for people to connect the dots as to when they're reading Scripture. And then moving on, we're going to start in section 5. It's called Rex Deus, Bloodlines of the Grail. So now what we're going to do is, after we've covered all of this material off, we've covered off the prophetic end to what's going to be taking place, we're going to go back now and we're going to cover off from 2000 forward, or year zero forward, in terms of the early history and right up close to the modern times, so that people have an understanding that they've been planning this not only for 6,000 years, but a resurgence at the time of the crucifixion. And so I'm going to start with in chapter 54, the Jerusalem church. And I'm going to explain how the Essenes are the third circle of religion, along with the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and how they connect in with the Gnostics, and how the Gnostics view the Jerusalem church as being quite different as to what the Bible says of the Jerusalem church and what their goals and ambitions were, and of course the deity of Jesus being one of those significant sort of aspects. And it's important to understand because this is part of how they're going to mold in and have been molding into Christianity and preparing it for the takeover for the end time and the Babylon religion. In chapter 55 is called Sex, Lies, and Fairy Tales, and it starts to talk about the bloodlines of the Grail, the bloodlines of the Nephilim, the bloodlines of the Antichrist. So we're going to talk about how they encode that into their various literature and have done so right from the beginning of time. It's a typical MO. In chapters 56 to 60 is going to talk about the modern start to secret societies as we understand it, beginning with the Knights Templar. So we're going to cover off all of the aspects of the Knights Templar. And in chapter 57, we're going to talk about the Priory of Sion, that they were real. And again, I have a document I can send people if they want that, to know where some of those sources from history come from. Even though it's well annotated in the book, I have this kind of laid out sort of all together for you if people want that. The St. Clairs, who create Freemasonry, and how they're connected into the Knights Templar through the St. Clairs that aren't normally mentioned, and we'll talk about that as that unfolds. And of course, St. Bernard and the Benedictine monks. So if you understand who the Templars are, you'll understand that there's two Cistercian monks that are in there, which are Benedictine monks, and so is St. Bernard. And he's the one who writes the constitution for the Templars. So we're going to talk all about them as who they are, as being the Gnostic fraternities that are molded within Catholicism, how that happens, and I'll cover more of that as the book unfolds on that. But understand that they connect back to the first branch of monasticism in the West that began with the Essenes, who take their religion back to Heliopolis and the Egyptians. And then we move on from there to a very important chapter. A couple of chapters, one being the Invisible College in chapter 60, and that is the modern beginning of science, and it's also known as the Royal College, and we'll talk about how and who the founders are, being Rosicrucians, and Freemasons and why they created them and how they're affecting all of science and education even to this day. In chapter 61 and 62 is going to focus in specifically on some important aspects of Grail legends, because the Holy Grail has a different meaning in polytheism, being an allegory for the bloodlines, not this chalice that people think about. And they reinvent Joseph of Arimathea into James. So when I talked about earlier about the Jerusalem church, you start to get a feel for what's being talked about. And it's important to understand these bloodlines, that they're going to, and people may be familiar with a fictional story, the Da Vinci Code, that talked about the bloodlines of Mary Magdalene and Jesus. That was a fictional story, but it reflects their true beliefs. So we're going to talk all about that and how that's also scioned in, I think falsely, for sure falsely, into the Nephilim and royal bloodlines. But that's going to be part of the pedigree that is going to be used to deceive people. And we're also going to talk about Skoda and Tamar in terms of how there's legends out there that the polytheists write about that have the remnant of Israel and the remnant of Judea fleeing to Scotland and to Ireland and interconnecting in with the bloodlines that come out of the Tuatha De Danann and into the kings of Camelot. So in chapter 64, we're going to move on to the kings of Camelot, and 65, the Merovingians, and show how they're linked in and how their bloodlines go back to the giants and to other Sion bloodlines that are including David and Saul, which is a very, very important concept for the King of Jerusalem title that they're going to claim at the abomination. And then chapter 66, I have more background information in terms of taking those bloodlines from the Merovingians and the Grail dynasties back to the Trojans and some of the lines of the giants like Albion, Magog, and Gog that are in both the French and the English history and how they scioned into these bloodlines. And, of course, that will come together in the Merovingian bloodline and then resurface in what I cover off in chapter 67, which is the unicorn dynasty of the Stuarts and how that becomes the most ignoble bloodline and the divine right to rule that they assert that goes back to the fallen angels. And as one of the leading bloodlines for the Antichrist. And so chapter 68 and the last chapter of section 5 ends with the guardians of the Antichrist. And it'll talk about the organizations that have protected these bloodlines. And you'll also learn that there is more than one Antichrist figure that's always ready to go. And that you'll get out of that, that there's also probably, and not probably, but you'll get out of that, that there are competing bloodlines for Antichrist. And that's why Jesus talks about more than one Antichrist, Antichrist in plural. So it's an important concept to keep in mind as we go into the end time. And then we move on to chapter 6 that I call A Rendezvous with Destiny, Anatomy of a Global Conspiracy. So we're going to talk about these organizations, and you're going to learn about what I call the trunk organizations of secret societies. And up the trunk are the main organizations, and you have all of these branches that are coming in to different heights of the tree based on who's responsible for what. And as you go up the higher order, you get more into the Royal Mason organization. So you're going to learn about all of those organizations. So chapters 69 through 71 is going to talk about Freemasonry, the New World Order. I like to jokingly talk about the Nephilim World Order, the 33rd degree, and what that means as an adept. Just as we covered off what that was in the ancient times, it's the same as in the newer organizations. And so when we understand that the Freemason organization is the lowest adept order on this trunk, and that they have an agenda, which I'll talk about, which is looking, focusing on politics and the military, understand all these organizations will have in the trunk have other organizations that intersect into them as you go up. So, and I'll talk about a few of them as we go up here. And chapter 72 is an interesting one because it's called
The Rothschilds, Rockefeller, Morgan axis. And what we're talking about here is how the bloodlines and the money took over and established a foothold in America to take over the levers of government and the money, and that the bloodlines of the families that I'm going to talk about in this chapter that report to the Rockefellers and the Rothschilds and the Morgan intersect with and try and scion and move up their bloodlines with the real pure blood of the European bloodlines that came out of the Middle East. And when we talk about these bloodlines, we're only talking about Western bloodlines. There are bloodlines all over the world. Again, that'll probably be something that comes up in my second book when I get that out. And chapter 75 is about global. Well, I've jumped ahead. Sorry on that. I'll back up one step. So chapter 73 is secret societies and the new age of Atlantis. So chapter 73 is going to show the religions of the secret societies, how they connect back to the antediluvian epoch, and how they connect into the Gnostics and theosophy and the new age and the polytheist religions today, and how they're working together to bring about world government and a world religion. Chapter 74 moves on to the Illuminati, so moving up from the Freemasons on that tree trunk, and the organizations that and the agenda that they have. And chapter 75 focuses specifically on this idea of global Gnosticism that they're going to try and bring about through these organizations and governments. And if we look at what's going on in the world constitution today in terms of trying to bring the religions together, this is the global Gnosticism where everybody compromises their religions, and it goes back to the original religion before the flood of polytheism and the religion of Babel, which is the same one because it crossed the flood through Hermes, as we talked about. That's all going to be linked back in. So you can see everything from the first part of the book is coming up in the last half of the book. We're going to cover off chapter 76, 1,000 points of light, what that means. You know, when they talk about the New World Order and the Bush family, who is famous for putting it in several speeches, both junior and senior, and how that connects into that counterfeit spirit that we talked about in the first half of the book, and why they want and need a universal religion and a world government to bring those 1,000 points of light together for their own purpose, for their own new age, their own new Atlantis, where they evolve into godhood. So we're going to cover all of that off. And chapter 77 moves up to the Rosicrucians. So moving up again on the trunk, and this is the combination of higher degrees and third degree and 33rd degree, just as Illuminati are higher. These are going to be higher in that degree order. And they're going to be a combination of ones moving up through initiation and the pure bloods who are initiated from childhood, and how 50% on the top end are all the pure bloods. So everything above that is now going to be the Royal Masonic Orders. So from the bloodlines of the giants and the bloodlines of the Nephilim and the royal bloodlines. And we'll cover that off in detail so people sort of have an understanding what's moving up. And we're going to talk briefly about what's above them in these Royal Masonic Orders as well. That's the Committee of 300. As you move up to the tree, and then the Council of 33 and the 13 Western families. And understand there's probably 13 Western families around the world as well. And then we're going to talk about the New Age Millennium that I talked about before, that they're going to be promising, where Antichrist is going to promise a 1,000-year reign, just as Jesus does. Will actually fulfill. And it's important to understand these concepts about what they're going to promise and what they're going to counterfeit, because they're going to counterfeit everything from an Armageddon to a counterfeit Messiah, a counterfeit religion, counterfeit prophets, counterfeit everything. And that's why the deception is going to be so hard to weigh through, and why this information is just so important for people, so you understand the language that they're talking in and how they're doing these things. And so in section seven, we move on to a section called the House of Dragon Bloodlines and the Prehistoric Giants. And again, we're going to roll all the information forward on everything that's sort of talked about in the book and talk about how this all comes together in that House of Dragon Bloodlines. And in chapter 79 through 80, called The Fairy Kingdoms and Ordo Draconis, we're going to talk about, as we mentioned earlier in the book, but bring it forward more in a way, and then finish it off in the last section about the Tuatha De Danann as being the fairy bloodline, and also, and the fair folk, and also the dragon bloodline. So you've got other bloodlines that are allegorically called dragon bloodlines and or fairy bloodlines, and the dragon bloodline represents the patriarchal bloodline, and the fairy bloodline represents the matriarchal bloodline. And how all of this is going into literature that's designed to brainwash people, whether it's through fairy tales, movies, vampire stories, you name it. And Ordo Draconis is the order that Vlad the Impaler belonged to, who Dracula was based on. So again, the Dracula stories are an allegory of the bloodlines and their dualistic beliefs of good versus evil, just inverted as how we would understand it. And he's the individual that Prince Charles says he takes his genealogy back to. And of course, Vlad takes his genealogy back to the Scythians who produced the Tuatha De Danann. I'll cover a little bit more of that in some of the later chapters, and I'll mention it again. So just sort of keep that in mind. And this happens after the fall of the Templars, Ordo Draconis, in about 1400, and the Templars fell in 1307. So this begins a process of taking thrones back in continental Europe that they've been pushed off on, to take those thrones back with their bloodlines, and to pursue the pursuits of Thoth, which is the beginning of the Renaissance. Chapters 81 and 82 is going to provide you information that's from a historical basis that's connected into this dragon allegory, and it's called Serpents and Dragons. And so I'm going to talk about the dragons, the types of dragons in prehistory and history. We're going to talk about the Nahash or the Nakash, as some people like to pronounce it, and how that's a serpentine type of being. And we're going to sort of firmly cement this snake dragon imagery that absolutely permeates these spurious organizations. I actually call them snake organizations, snake societies in the book, because it goes back to the fiery serpent angels, and you'll learn all about that in the book as well. Of course, those are the rebellious serpent angels that we talked about in the first part of the book. And then chapter 81 and 82, we're also going to talk about Leviathan, because it's connected in the serpentine imagery that is part of the dragon imagery in the House of Dragon. And we're going to cover off in prehistory how the Leviathan, who is a serpent type of being in the Bible, where one of them is destroyed, and as Isaiah says, the second one is going to be destroyed in the end time, is also understood by different names in other cultures, like Tiamat or Apep or Lotan or Yam, and every culture has a name for it. So again, they have a similar accounting, just manipulated from a polytheist perspective. And then chapter 83 is called The Cainite Cult of Melchizedek, which brings back into the Essenes and their Egyptian Heliopolis polytheist religion, and the Cainite pantheon of El, whose offspring was Baal and the Baalim of the post-Diluvian epoch, and as part of the offspring gods. And 84 will cover the Essenes off in detail, and how the secret societies take their beginnings in the West after Jesus back to the Essenes, who are also, as I mentioned, the genesis for the monastic orders in the Catholic Church, like Franciscans and Benedictines and on and on and on. And in chapters 85 to 87, we're going to start back on what I would call how they're going to represent history to partially take down and demoralize Christians and Jewish people, and connections back into Islam as well. So we're going to cover off Moses and chapter 85, how he's connected the Akhenaten and polytheism and the Armana dynasty. And they're going to sever, and how they sever monotheism at that point in time, because that's the intersection of Islam, Judaism, and Christianity, as well as Abraham. And they're going to hit both of those and reinvent that history, that Moses actually brought back a polytheist religion, not a rogue monotheist religion that takes over after Moses dies. So we're going to cover all of that off. And chapter 86 is going to show how they link Joseph into all of this, and how he's connected into the dragon bloodlines that come out of the Armana dynasty. Chapter 87 is going to detail Abraham, Esau, and Ishmael, and how that all fits in as they start to reinvent them and craft them into the bloodlines, as well as chapter 89. We're going to go even further back into history and talk about the kings of Nimrod and Ham, and how Nimrod, after Babel, is going to intermarry into the Rephaim bloodline, creating hybrid dynasties that are going to be working throughout history. So expect a Nimrod connection for the end time as part of that pedigree, and how they reinvent Ham, as well as chapter 89 is going to talk about Ham and Japheth together and how they intermarried with the giants and the bloodlines. In chapter 91 and 92 are going to go back after or before the flood and talk about the antediluvian kings of Sumeria. So the blood-drinking kings of Kish, the antediluvian dragon court, and Adam and Cain, and how, in their belief system, how they weave the Cainite lineage and Adam into that bloodline that's connected with Amaka Seth that we talked about earlier. And then a special chapter to show where Lilith fits in with her owl and fairy imagery, and being also part of that mother goddess sort of imagery. But you'll learn all about where Lilith comes from and how that intersects. And then finally, in wrapping things up, we have a small section 8, chapters 94 through 98. And we're going to nail down, starting in chapter 94, called The Grail Cauldron of Fairies and Wind and Atlantis. I'm going to pull all of those together to show the consistency of the allegories that they've written in there and the bloodlines that they've written in there, and particularly focus on the fairy matriarchal bloodline aspect of mermaids, fairy queens, fairy queens of the Tuatha De Danann, as they fit into, let's say, Guinevere of King Arthur, and how that connects back to Mary Magdalene in those bloodlines that are woven through the Grail stories in allegories. And as you go through this, you're starting to learn that you're going to learn about how they use their literature to post and keep their history, their belief system, and their genealogies. It's all part of the allegorical interpretive religion that you're going to learn about early on in the book, and how you need to be an adept to understand that. But you're going to pick up on the language that they're talking about to recognize that. Just as King Arthur is a Pendragon, his queen is a fairy queen mother, which is Guinevere. So I'll give you a sort of a quick insight on that. So you're going to learn all about those things. In chapter 95 through 96 are the fairy lords of the Tuatha De Danann and the royal house of the Scythians. And what we're going to connect back here is how these Tuatha De Danann and the Scythians and the Celt bloodlines and the European bloodlines in the polytheist belief system sprung out from the Scythians, both into the south and into Sumer and into the Middle East and into Europe, north up the Danube and over to England, from the tribe of Danu, or the Tuatha De Danann. And that's sort of a double entendre in the meaning. So Tuatha is tribe. Dea is sometimes translated as a god, and Danann is kind of a play on words for the mother goddess Diane, who's the queen of the fairies in the Roman and the Etruscan pantheons, and Danu. Anu being so the tribe of D apostrophe Anu, or the Sumerian god who created the Anunnaki, both of heaven and earth, and the earth ones are the Anunnaki giants. And of course, Enlil and Anki would be gods of the pair of the offspring gods of the Sumerian pantheon, with Anu being their father. And so we're going to connect all of that back, so you understand how these bloodlines went forward and how they're connected to all the bloodlines that we're talking about throughout the book. And in chapters 97 and 98, just sort of rolls forward as to all of this knowledge and this cult of knowledge, the cult of Gnosticism, the seven sacred sciences, everything that polytheism talks about. I wrap it up in the antediluvian testimony, talking about whether it's the pearls of wisdom or the Shatia or the golden apples or the archives of the Masons. This is the same bank of knowledge, just with a different allegory to it, that they're going to bring out as we get closer to the end time. That has all the knowledge that they say that ever was or ever will be, and is part of what's going to be accessed to the mark of the beast in the end time. And then I finish up with chapter 98. It's called the Chem of Mendes. And we're going to talk about Azazel, how he's connected to the Chem of Mendes in Egypt, and how he's connected to the secret societies as one of the most important gods that they worship, as a god of war and a god of knowledge, and why he's hung upside down at Roslyn Chapel built by the Sinclairs. And that is essentially the book. So it's a 6,000-year connect the dots investigation into the House of Dragon, into the bloodlines of the royal families, who, even though they're not visibly shown as running things today, are still controlling things in the background. And as we see the rise of the Babylon religion and the Ten King Empire, as it rises out of the Roman Empire, these Ten Kings will represent those bloodlines as the descendants. Are you there, Brother John?
Yes. I just got the Kindle version of your book, because now I just don't know when I'm going to have the time. I've just got to shave the time off to start digging on some of this stuff. But this particular high-level summary that marches you through and creates a circular connection to all of these things. I mean, you're touching upon the Committee of 300. That is vast. I mean, I have studied, a lot of, the whole conspirators hierarchy, if you want to call it that, the Rhodes Roundtable and these different groups, and for years. But to be able to see how all of this labyrinthine, for lack of a better term, synergy exists going back thousands of years of time, and see the interconnection through, as you pointed out, the occult allegory is really amazing. And definitely, in my understanding of things, is a missing link. I even got at one point, what a futile operation that was, but I had invested in a really great program. I forget what it was called, and I have it here on my computer, but I'm not going to waste time looking it up. But it was a really good quality three-dimensional mind mapping program. Really incredible product. And I worked on that thing so hard for probably about a year. It was vast, because I knew there was an interconnecting, I don't know what you want to call it. There was all the dots connected. I knew that. And so I started to take all the information that I was gleaning from the various books that I was reading and saying, okay, well, this is connected to this, is connected to this through this family, through this funding, and it comes from these guys, and I got to a point where the mind mapping program was so
it was just layers upon layers. It must have had 100 layers of data and groups and, you know, and it got to the point where it was no longer useful because it was so labyrinthic, humongous, and you were like, what have I accomplished after 6 months of entering data into this thing? Nothing. You can't track it back to its origin. And it seems like you've done probably the best job out there of anybody doing that. It's amazing.
Well, it's important that if you don't understand how the royal bloodlines fit in and the religious aspect fits in, it's very difficult to try and figure out, as you call that, labyrinth, because there's just so many groups. I mean, it's so vast that you don't even want to believe it's so vast. But if you understand how their hierarchy kind of works, then it starts to make some sense. So, you know, if you look at, let's say, you know, the Bilderbergers, which people are quite familiar with because some of the pseudo blue bloods who would want to intermarry for their posterity going forward to move up into the cult, because the purer your bloodline is where you fit in that culture, they will go once a year to a meeting to get their marching orders. But they're being given their marching orders by pure bloods. That would be like, you know, like the Dutch royal family, for example, would be active in that group and many of the European bloodlines, and they would intersect back into, you know, a very high level that would go back into the 13 families by the representation that's in there, right? So that's one of those branches that would come out, along with a lot of other royal Masonic orders. Or if you have like the the Knights of St. John or the Knights of Malta, and they've had several names over the millennia, they would have, as people running those organizations within the Catholic Church, they need to be of the royal bloodline and not the first heir, but probably the second and the third. So that's going to be going intersecting into the tree up into probably the royal families as well of the 13, and or just below that with the Council of 33, and some of them even down to, you know, the Committee of 300. And the Committee of 300 has an organization that branches into them called the Club of Rome. And they're the ones who were created in the late 60s to come up with a map and a plan to set up the 10 kings. So if you Google the Club of Rome and their map, they've got the world arbitrarily divided up into 10 groups of nations. And that's what they're trying to bring about. And so you would have some of the lower bloodlines working, but they would be answering to, in that organization, the pure bloods that would intersect back into the tree at the Committee of 300. Some people say the Rosicrucians at the top level, but probably more likely the Committee of 300. So if you're looking at, let's say, media and things like that and literature and where the people get the information to write this stuff, now you know that if you understand what the agenda of the Rosicrucians are, which is to preserve the knowledge, to preserve the genealogies, to preserve the religion, to preserve the bloodlines in literature, you're going to have organizations branching in out of the Rosicrucian Society. So a classic one would be the Inkling Society that Lewis and Tolkien were involved on. That was a Golden Dawn order, which is a Rosicrucian order, and that was at Oxford College. But Lewis and Tolkien weren't Freemasons. But if you understand their purebloods, and I've got documents for people on Tolkien and Lewis, a six-part series, with two documents on their bloodlines, they're actually royal bloodlines, and they're initiated from childhood. So they're actually an adept before they can take the title, which comes close to 30 years old. So they would have been allowed in a Rosicrucian society and an Inkling writing society to write their works, to learn the craft of the knowledge that they already knew.
It's absolutely fascinating and amazing. And, you know, I was just dabbling around here and, you know, because I jump from book to book because I see interconnections from various chapters and stuff. And, you know, just coming to the realization that the French and Bolshevik revolutions, their primary enemy were Christians, you know, just little pieces like that kind of connect all these dots, and at the end of the day, it maps back beautifully to the old Genesis 6 event.
It all does.
It gives you that the missing link, the quid bono, who benefits, what's their motive, what, you know, and then wow, because you see. Like, I was having a conversation with somebody. I don't want to drag it on too far because I got to go to bed. I know you do too, but I'm just saying, like, one of the points I was bringing up with somebody was like, they were like, well, George Soros this and George Soros that. I said, no. You have to understand what you're dealing with here. You would be best to think of it in terms of, you know, organized crime and the Godfather. The Godfather is essentially Satan. And he does show up in person at if you're at a high enough of a level of the meeting, he will actually show up in person and sit at the board table with the people in person. Okay, and he does that too also with black masses and things. But the point I'm trying to make is, if you compare it, if you align it with the organizational structure of a very powerful organized crime family, Soros is nothing more than a captain. He's just over, he has a particular duty.
Exactly.
But he isn't calling the shots. The shots are coming from way up high. And it passes down through so many levels before it gets down to the executioner. That they can't, it's just not traceable. And it's exactly like what you see in organized crime movies. You're never going to trace it back to the Godfather. No way. So that's what I love about
the book.
And there's
a couple of reasons for that too, because if they're visible, they're the front man. So take the Rothschilds, their name before they were funded by the Royal Masonic organizations, or the Bowers, and they only changed their name to the Rothschilds when they set up the London Bank in about 1800 or 1810. So they were introduced late in it, but they're the front, so they're not going to be the purebloods. Not that they're not high up, they're just not anywhere close to the top. So if you see them, they're not the ones you need to be concerned about who's running things. And it's interesting, the analogy on the mafia crime family. That's just another secret society. I mean, it's set up the same way. You have to be initiated, and you have to move up, and it's got an organizational structure. They learn things, and they work in hand with the governments.
Oh, they do. It's amazing. I studied maybe about 6 months. I dedicated all of my time, my free time, to trying to get my arms around, you know, at least a portion of the Illuminati web. And, you know, people think that that's kind of like, I don't know, like just a generic term, but it's not. You've got the bloodline Illuminati, you've got the ones, it's very much like a crime family. You got the ones that are part of the Soprano family and their blood. And then you got the ones that come in and they go in and they do what they got to do to prove themselves, and then they get brought in. But you're never going to be blood if you're not blood. All right, so you're always kind of like an outsider, but you can be part of the Illuminati family. But the Illuminati, like when I was reading the book about the Brotherhood of Satan and all the creepy, weird stuff that they do, and they're very powerful. A lot of people don't realize. Now, of course, the less you hear about them, the more powerful they are. But I was studying like the works that this particular individual was brought up. Bloodline Illuminati. What Bloodline Illuminati basically means: you're part of the bloodline. They have children within. In secret, they use midwives, and they bequeath the fetus to Satan in ceremony. So the baby, before it is even born, is already owned ultimately by Satan. Period. End of story. Then they designate them for certain particular specializations. In this particular case, they have very unusual upbringings. The children are trained early at the age of 2-3 years old. They're awakened routinely, pretty much on a nightly basis, at around 2 o'clock in the morning. And they take them to specially designated places for training purposes and also for ritual ceremony stuff. It's pretty dark and sick and you don't want to repeat. But it's part of the splitting of their mind and creating mind control slaves. It's SRADID stuff. It's really dark. But the point is, I was studying a person who was designated, it was a female, who was designated as an Illuminati trainer. That was her job. Now, there's a lot of jobs that they have that they're designated to do and they're programmed to do at a very young age. And her job was specifically to train other members of the Illuminati for specific roles, which can be anything. I mean, it's a whole portfolio of specializations that, you know, make the born identity stuff come to life. But anyway, they would wake up, you know, at 2 o'clock in the morning. And, you know, this was when she was older and she was already designated as a trainer. And I don't know if they had some kind of a certification, but she was officially a trainer at this point. And they had compounds. They had these protected compounds and no one knew where they were. There was no obvious entry to the compounds, kind of like the hillbillies in North Georgia. You don't know the entryway. You don't know where, if you don't know where, what two trees to turn between, you're never going to get up into the hillbillies. They're hidden way too well. So these compounds, the compounds are protected by very senior law enforcement and military operatives that are part of either blood, but usually not blood. Usually the people that do the security work are indoctrinated into the group. They're not the actual blood family members. The actual blood family members operate deep in the compounds doing the training and the stuff that they do to program the operatives. But when they're doing that at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, they have full-blown black slate military power. So it may be a 5-mile drive off of this tiny country road. You've got to know where to turn, where the two trees are or whatever, to know where to turn, because there's no obvious entry into that road. It's covered with leaves, you know, it's a dirt road. And they put essentially Delta Force grade black slate, black ops, military and law enforcement personnel in trees with night vision and encrypted radio communications. They actually sit high up in trees so that they can see anything approaching from the sky or from the street miles and miles away. And they actually practice so that if there's a call that comes in on the encrypted line that someone or something is approaching the compound, they have with military precision, they can break down all their satanic altars. They can break down all of the training rooms where they do awful things to children. They can break them all down, clean them all up, get rid of all the evidence, and disappear into the forest before the car can make it up to the compound. That's how good they are. And they are, and they have, we're talking about, you know, I was not surprised, I don't think you were at all, to watch what happened to Trump with the Supreme Court and all of them, because people do not realize how infiltrated the government is, how infiltrated these very senior officials and judges all over the United States, their own. They are owned. And so when we were seeing one, legal suit after another getting rejected by this Secretary of State, that Secretary of State, when we had video evidence, we could see it with our own eyes. We knew that the fraud had taken place. And yet they're still standing there going, nope, didn't happen. The judge is like, I reject it. I'm not even going to hear it. They're all infiltrated. They're owned. They're all part of that web. And It's kind of like I tell people, it's not just game over. We're literally standing outside the stadium pointing to the bubblegum wrappers. The cars are already out of the parking lot. I mean, you know what I'm saying? And it's just, if it wasn't for the hand of our Heavenly Father, this, it would already be, well, we would already be getting marched in and getting decapitated. Because that's really their ultimate goal. Their ultimate goal is drinking our blood, cutting off our heads, and having us renounce Jesus. I mean, really, at the end of the day, that's their big moment. They can't wait for that. And praise God for his angels and his power.
Yeah, they consider us cattle, so they only want us for servitude and sacrifice.
Yep, yep. Goes all the way back to the Mayans. I mean, it really does track far back as you can go. The further, I thought at some point I would hit an end to it, but you never really do. You just keep on going back. I even had one book. You know, again, I'm not one of those people that says, well, this is the truth, and I'm sticking with this story. I always keep an open mind because there's always more to learn. But I had this one white paper that I found that claimed that the inhabitants of the land of Canaan go beyond the earth. In other words, the inhabitants of the land of Canaan. See, now we like to believe, because when we do our homework and our research and everything, we like to trace everything back to Adam and Eve. So we go, okay, Adamic bloodline, you got the curse of Ham, da 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 da. There, I would argue that there are some flaws in that, because we don't take in the 90. We don't take in the 9 months of gestation periods when we're looking at the genealogies. The timing does not add up mathematically. We make a lot of assumptions. But I read this white paper and I was like, now that makes sense to me, that the people from Canaan, the original inhabitants of the land of Canaan, weren't from Earth at all. You know, and God, and you have that period, that thing where God says that he had actually made a comment where he was like something along the lines of that he was regretting having chosen planet Earth in the first place. And then you start going back to the Sumerian kings list, 400,000 years, and the Anunnaki and the gold and everything else, and all of the different creatures of Atlantis and Lemuria and the things that the Egyptians painted on their walls. And that's all pre-Adamic. Wow, I mean, the story of Earth and how much history and how many creatures and how many civilizations and what's from Earth and what's not from Earth, and, you know, because there's a lot. I mean, if you go back and you dig and you start arguing, you know, some of these points, there's a lot of questions that cannot be answered. There's a lot, you know, where did those people come from? There are references in early Genesis to civilizations that obviously logic indicates that they weren't from the Adamic bloodline, you know, and you can't answer it. And I've seen people debate it. And the only answer is an incursion from some other planet, some other place that's beyond it. Even, you know, you got the Pember book that's about, you know, civilizations. You've got J. Vernon McGee in his book Through the Bible. He makes it clear that the Luciferian Rebellion, that there were civilizations of mankind before that occurred, before Genesis 1:1 and 1:2. McGee. So it's really an explosive amount of information. And I had to get your book. Now I just have to figure out how I can retire early and focus on reading everything.
It will take some time.
I know. I'll have to like chisel away at it, kind of like Mount Rushmore, you know?
Yep.
Oh, well, thank you so much.
It's written that you can leave it and come back as you want, because it's each chapter is a mini story. So it's written with the understanding that it's going to take time to read.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons why I like Kindle, because I take notes. You know, then I can go back and refresh my memory. Oh, okay, I know what I'm okay, that kind of thing. Yeah, so thank you so much for joining us. Always really elucidating to have you join us and just kind of tie some knots and connect some dots, because it's a story that is just staggering in its depth. And it is my opinion that you have done the best job of anybody out there. There's nothing.
Well, thank
I don't
you.
Think another book that even comes close to the depth that you have gotten with this. So this is incredible.
Appreciate
that. Conspiracy book by Gary Wayne. What's your website again?
Genesis6conspiracy.com. That's Genesis 6 with the number 6, conspiracy.com.
That's awesome. Well, praise God. Thank you so much, Brother Gary, for joining us again tonight. I love bringing you on because there's so much to learn, and it is so fascinating. Again, God bless you. And, folks, let's see. We're looking at Wednesday, so we'll see you at the Friday Night Prayer Vigil, 8 p.m., Lord willing. Thank you, Brother Gary. God bless you so much.
Thank you.
Powerful work. We'll see you Friday night.